Hey, Podcast America, welcome to episode 52. That's right, 52 weeks, 1 year of the Enlightened Neanderthals podcast.
Woo! Here we go. Yeah. Nice job, boys.
Yeah.
I love it. And before we get into it, I want to talk about my own company, Training Northwest. The Rifleman camp is about two-thirds full, so there's still, I think, six slots up for grabs. If you guys want to head over to trainingnorthwestllc.com, again, that's a three-day immersion into sort of some basic skills you need to be a modern-day Minuteman, if that's something you fancy. One change I did make is this year we're going to include ham radio in the curriculum, and I think I'm also going to teach the Aussie peel, which for people who know what that is, it's a lot of running and shooting, and it's a tactic used for breaking contact, and I think that will give people it's a really fun drill to practice.
Is that first day, second day?
It'll be second or third day.
Third day then. Sounds like a lot of work.
There's going to be some ability.
We will maintain the casualty extraction under fire on the third day. So it's going to have to be second day. But it's like everything at that camp is crawl, walk, run. So we'll crawl, walk, run it. Mm-hmm. And if there's safety concerns at the walk phase, we won't run. We'll just walk.
I'm putty in your hands, so you get ready to mold me, Tobin.
Oh, I will. I will mold you two-handed.
Oh, gross.
Yeah, dude.
Oh, wow.
Why can't I quit you?
Oh, man.
Rifleman camp, sorry.
Yeah. Well, let's move on.
We should, yes.
Electric North Jiu-Jitsu, Pantheon of Podcasts. Mike, yes. Hang on, Jordan. What are they?
Look at that. 1 year. Here we go.
Christy Campbell's Coffee Talk.
Boom.
Yeah. What
else? Are you passing it? Or are we giving it all?
No. I just want to see if you can do them all.
Oh, Tyler Stanaway and The Compassionate Viking.
Boom, too.
Will,
what is his name, Jordan?
What's that?
What's his name?
No-tell.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. What's his podcast?
That's the Patriotic Islander.
Boom, that's three.
And we got the White Belt Mafia with Daddy Leyland.
Daddy Danny.
And that's it. And then we got the
Grand Poobah.
Endless Endeavor with old Greg Anderson.
The black sheep himself.
Gregory Anderson.
The metalhead. Did you guys see that photo he sent in that group text of
his eighth grade picture wearing a Pantera tee? Yeah, it's awesome.
Okay. That's what I need to picture when I want to strangle him. I can't look at him at Greg as the man he is now. I need to look at that dork like right before I slap and bump and be like, I'm going to kill you.
Yeah, look at you, 15-year-old Greg.
Homo.
Nerd.
Okay. Yeah.
All right, Mike.
Tobin.
For the 1 year, you wanted to do a, we're on another apocalypse.
Well, this was a two-parter, I feel like. The first part was a Ask Kiss Rodeo for ourselves. We slapped ourselves on the back and on the butt, boys, because we did hit a year of doing this tomfoolery, this blasphemy that people seem, certain people of a higher intelligence, I would say, subscribe or like, but we hit a year.
A refined palate,
some would say. We've grown like, not a culture, but like our own little style.
Yeah. We've hit a rhythm.
We hit our strides. So
hit a rhyme.
Congratulations.
And come on, rhyme. All. It's podcast time.
Oh, my God.
Need I say more?
Nope. Enjoy the show, you guys.
Yeah.
All right. Here we go. Episode 52, 1 year. Not by the calendar,
music.
But by the... by the number of weeks that we've managed to record a podcast, minus a few that we threw away because they were sort of unlistenable.
Everything's gold. What are you talking about? Yeah. Maybe one day we'll release it on a Patreon. The hidden gems.
Oh, I don't know. Those are hidden gems.
I don't know if they're gems. They're hidden, all right?
Down.
And I still like, I want to put it out there again because I like your idea of someday selling out a theater and... Will texted. I don't know if you guys saw it or paid attention to it, but Will texted us the other day that his buddy who owns the Korean barbecue said we can get a booth and record an episode that there sometime. So I think we're going to have to put that on the short-term calendar here.
That's one step closer to a theater, right? Yeah.
Start. And then imagine all the poor people who are in there trying to have a family dinner and like, what are these three jackasses doing over here in the corner? Yeah.
So Biden.
Yeah. My butthole itches. What?
Kimchi. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And we kind of already covered a little bit of it. What episode was that where we sort of impromptuly started talking about the 1 year?
I said fan questions.
Fan questions.
Did we ever get a question, Jordan?
I got off of
Is our internet. Social media rep.
Our social media rep doesn't do social media.
Yeah. Social media is fucking stupid.
No, we all know
it. Yes, it is. Yeah. Yes, it is.
Those pigeons were a bad idea.
It actually makes me happy to hear you're ignoring Instagram because more and more I'm only on it just for the sake of free marketing for Training Northwest, and it's about the only marketing I have. But fuck Instagram because they censor me, and everything I post is just added. I'm supporting their business by posting content for other people to look at when they're mindlessly scrolling through, drooling on themselves, and they are actively censoring me. So it's a terrible business model, and I wish that there was some alternative. I wish somebody would come up with an alternative social media platform. Twitter isn't great for marketing. Twitter isn't good for marketing. Twitter's just for people to argue.
Depends on what you do, but
at least I'm not good at. And honestly, it's another one where I open it and I start to scroll for a minute, and I'm like, "This is stupid."
We need to make you a promo video of thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming.
What was that guy? I'm Larry Elder, or no? That's
I'm
the
Larry
church
Potterfield.
Guy. Larry Potterfield. Yeah, thanks for your business. Yeah, we needed that for Training Northwest.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
So, I guess we already talked about expectations for what we thought the podcast would be.
Yeah, we already
covered that.
I'm so famous in my head, Danielle, sick of hearing about it.
look, 10 people.
Yeah.
Have sent us messages.
Yeah, I've got like 3 direct messages, like, good job. It's like, I'm crushing it, right?
We had a guy, a super cool guy named Tyson, came out to my class this last Saturday. He came over from Spokane, and he's a podcast fan.
Oh.
And so that was actually kind of cool. Super, like I said, he was a cool guy to hang out with. He trains jiu-jitsu in Spokane. Somehow he got onto Greg's podcast and then got onto our podcast. He's participating in the Summer of Trans. He's lost a bunch of weight.
Oh,
eating,
shit.
Good job. Eating steak and apples and rolling at his gym. And
well, that's all you need to do.
Yeah.
Did he, what was he doing before? Anything or just kind of?
Before what? Like
before he started?
Training-wise?
Yeah,
or
yeah.
I don't think so. And we didn't get that deep just because time. I'm always stressed for time on those days. I'm trying to get set up early and get the class. You know, I want the class started right on time. People are wanting to bullshit, and then between classes, I'm trying to get reset up, press start. You know what I mean?
It's like
people want to bullshit, and I'm like, I got to run away.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah.
We had a good little weekend, though.
Did you?
On Friday? We did the class on Friday.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Cool. Yeah. We had a... Goddamn, my brain is mush because I haven't had a day off in a long time.
That was Friday.
Yeah, I had a corporate group out there, and they wanted to cover catering as well. So it was pretty awesome for the guys who were out there because their company paid for the class, paid for the ammo, and paid for Jordan to cater it. So we had...
Nice.
Yeah, for Ed. Cost.
The cornbread, huh?
Yeah,
it's exactly. All coming together
now.
Boy.
The cornbread's coming together, right? Right. So we had brisket and ribs out there after class, little campfire going. Mm-hmm. The weather was still cold and wet, but otherwise everything
it held
went
off
though.
Yeah,
that's true. It did not rain on us while we were eating.
It was nice.
So it was perfect.
Immediately after we were soaked.
But it's kind of one of those things where like standing back though. When they were eating, nobody was talking about it. I was like, oh, did I screw up? And then I tasted it, and I was like, oh, this is good.
It was good.
This guy.
And you sent me home with ribs and brisket, and Zach and I have been chowing down on ribs and brisket the last 3 nights, and it's fucking delicious.
Good. I'm glad.
Yeah. And I think that's going to be the model going forward after this summer is a lot less publicly listed classes and a lot more private groups, whether it's, you know, I've said it before on here, I've got church groups, I've had bachelor parties, I've had corporate team building days. And I think from, you know, not from now on, but from New Year's Eve 2025 on, I'll probably only post maybe one or two publicly available shooting classes, and the rest is going to be...
And then Rifleman Camp.
Rifleman Camp will happen every year. Maybe probably a level one and a level two class posted for the public, and the rest will be by appointment only as private groups. And then also, Brett and I are also cooking up some more stuff that I'm not going to talk about yet because we're still, you know, sort of tickling our brains and trying to figure out what to do. But we've got some cool stuff coming, maybe early fall or early next year.
Nice.
Yeah. That'll be cool.
It's cool indeed. You get to pick your clientele. Like, that's something I like about business. It's not like, I always say it, I do like how I get to work for insurance companies, because the work is already provided and there's a standard of it used to look like this. Now make it look like how it used to. Just fix it like that. And then so you kind of have consistency in knowing what you're getting into. When you are constantly open to the public, you don't have a filter of who you're giving your service or product to. So you can get a person that's 1,000% committed at the beginning, but then gives up in the end and doesn't follow through with money, or they constantly change your mind, or So it's cool to be as a business owner in a position where it's not like, where you're like, I'm going to limit my general public classes because I've established enough of a reputation of return customers of, something a little higher than just, hey, I just got a gun, I want to learn how to shoot. Yeah. Have people that are starting to dedicate, they like the art of it. And so you're going to start getting blue belts and
your actually,
business becomes a blue belt and then a purple belt too at the same time as your clients move up.
Yep. And I think the classes that I do offer publicly will be, I said level one, level two, it'll probably be more likely my foundation beginner's class and a level one, because that's what most people need, is the basic introductory level. And there's very few people out there who are genuinely ready for a level two.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of dudes want to believe they are, but more and more I'm starting to also learn to let people fail, just so that maybe what they learn at a level two class is like Greg says, what you're not.
Yeah.
You know, the mats will teach you what you are not. And I have discovered some ways on the range to let people figure out, without me doing anything, I let them figure out what they are not.
Let them stumble. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Nice work, John Wick.
Because I get a lot of people.
First guy to cry at Rifleman Camp. Oh, it's going to be awesome.
Jordan.
Don't worry, I won't smoke.
Out of the grass.
Oh, yeah. I do get a lot of customer contacts who ask, hey, I'd like to come out to class. Can I just sign up for level two? And I'll say, it doesn't bother me as long as you're safe and competent with your firearm. But you may be frustrated if you bypass level one. And if your marksmanship is not on point, level two can get real frustrating. And I used to sort of pad it and come up with ways to let them progress through. And then at some point I realized that was stupid because I'm helping them pad their ego.
Yeah.
And now I allow them to fail.
Yeah.
And that honestly, there's a lot of learning value in showing up and failing and having a frustrating day.
Yeah. Oh, so, absolutely.
Yeah.
You see, and I mean, at the same time, like allowing them to fail, but then I think some people with ego might go, oh, that class sucks.
Yeah.
You go, but that's where you kind of have to say, like, here's the deal.
And that's anything you do that's publicly available as a business. There's going to be critics who want to poo-poo
but
it.
I mean, it's
whatever.
But that's where you go, hey, here's a little explanation can go a long way in that, and saying, hey, some of you might not belong here today, and that's okay, but you're going to find out where you do belong, when that's fine.
Yep.
And,
if you get through 45 rounds, all three pistol magazines at one barricade without hitting my steel target, and you just can't finish the drill because you're out of ammo, well, then
I'm going into town to get more. Yeah, and exactly. I'll see you in 25 minutes.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Bring me coffee.
Yeah. You should get a deal with the local hardware store for ammo. Send people down there.
I've actually been ordering it from Steve over there in Goldendale. I like that guy.
Yeah.
So awesome. Let's give a shout out to High Desert Cartridge Company, made over in Goldendale, Washington. Former, he's a DEA officer, agent. And he teaches courses very similar to what I do over in Goldendale. So if you guys are East Siders or over in the Yakima area,
he runs an option. He runs an awesome class.
Yeah. And he's an ammunition manufacturer. So I've started ordering all my ammunition from him.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Shout out.
Yeah. Again, High Desert Cartridge Company. And what does he call his training company?
It is the Cerebrus.
Cerebrus?
Is it the three-headed dog, right?
Cerberus?
Cerberus.
Something like that.
Cerberus, that's right. Cerberus Training Group.
That's a good dog name.
Oh, dude. Next dog.
You should name your fucking dog that bit me Cerberus.
Cerberus.
I think I'm going to.
Yeah, that is. No, that is Lucifer. That is beyond super.
Maybe I kill three of my dogs and the last one live and I name.
Cerberus.
There you go. Yeah.
Yep. You would have such a weird dog fighting ring if you made all your dogs fight to the death.
Oh, I don't know that they could. Indy's missing half his teeth. Rory's too shy.
I thought I had a walk-on yesterday, and I actually named it Jordan. But this old brown dog just kind of came in. it just came in and laid down in the garage while I was out there monkeying with the dirt bike.
Oh, really?
And I was like, all right, I guess that's cool. And then she followed. Boy. Yeah. And then she followed me into the house.
Oh.
I was like, I don't know if you should do that. And then she just followed, for like 2 hours, she followed me everywhere I went, right on my heel. And I was like, oh, fuck. No tag on her collar. Maybe someone.
You're good to go.
Yeah. Well, you know how people just like grandma dies or whatever, and they don't know what to do with the dog, so they just drop it off somewhere far away from home. And I was like, God dang it. I'm not going to put this dog out in the cold tonight.
Jordan.
And so,
poor Jordan out in the cold.
Yeah, exactly. And I was like, I'm going to call it Jordan.
Me. Yeah. That, if I showed up and you were like, hey, meet Jordan, I'd be like, fuck you, dude.
He just slipped that in that story so perfect. This dog showed up, named him Jordan. And I was like, well, hey, buddy.
So anyway, I got a sleeping bag out of the closet and I laid it out so Jordan would have somewhere to sleep. And I just thought, you know what? This might be a neighbor's dog. So I'll just leave the back door open.
Yeah.
And at some point, she got up and left.
Moseyed out.
Yeah, I don't know where she went. So.
Yeah. Well,
whatever.
It's like, if I can't be with the human.
I just wish he adopted it, just took to it immediately.
Yeah.
And like, he puts a shotgun in the car. They're off to Petco to go get food. And the neighbor that owns it's walking the street looking for him. Sees him hauling ass. Dog Jordan hanging out the window.
She's happier with me, dude. Yeah. Oh, man.
Dude, you're a dog squatter.
Yeah,
apparently. Yeah, you're a dog squatter.
But actually, it would actually be better than having my own dog if it's just a neighbor's dog who likes to come hang out sometimes.
Get the fuck out of here.
Because I don't have to clean up poop or buy dog food or take it to the vet. Yeah, say,
hey, your dog's
like
shit
that.
In my yard.
Yeah, exactly.
Good boy.
It's doing that weird throw-up thing by the door.
Yeah.
Oh, you drank way too much beer.
Hey, one year.
Come get your dog. He's fucked up.
I got you guys something. Cause it
popped. A backpack? Cool.
It popped into used backpack I got from work. Yeah,
JanSport.
You know, if something pops into your head, you have like this idea, and then you're like, well, now it's happening. There's like no chance to, it has to happen because I fucking talk about this all the time.
No fucking way, that's yours. Dude.
No way.
You're kidding me.
A Grands Force Brook.
That you is did a not.
Grands Force Brook.
No way, Tobin.
Because I got you something, but it's nowhere near this cool.
No, and I thought about that. This is not a one up competition, but like I said, it popped into my head, and I was like, I have to do this now.
Holy
now that it's,
shit.
Now
dude.
That the idea has been hatched, it has to be manifested.
Oh, my God.
Dude, these are awesome.
Thank you so much, dude.
That is so sharp.
Yeah, dude.
Axe fight in the front yard.
Fuck yeah.
Man. A lot of scalping we could do with these.
Oh, yeah.
I'll be honest. I didn't get you guys anything, but I love you, and I want to provide good content.
Just your comradeship.
Yeah. Hello, friend.
You've done funny. No, the other day, we were talking about that. I'll bring it, and it's not that big of a deal.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
It's not like this. My God, dude.
These are awesome.
This is one of the best gifts I've gotten ever.
Awesome.
So,
well, that makes me happy.
Yeah, it makes me super happy.
I knew Jordan would be stoked.
Oh, dude,
and once the idea puts itself in your brain, then there's no going back.
Holy shit.
Jordan's excited. He's gonna knack. Was it Prima Nocta?
Prima Nocta. It's
like, thank you so much. Here you go.
Dude, this is fucking wild.
Yeah.
Which actually, thank you so much, man.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Truly.
Thank you guys.
Awesome.
This has been a hell of a year. And like I said, whenever the last time we were talking about coming up on 1 year was, we've gone from barely knowing each other to you guys are two of my best friends.
Absolutely.
Just from sitting around whatever shitty table we're at talking shit into these microphones. Well, so it's been, if nothing else, if we fall back to 7 listeners, it's been 100% worth it.
Fucking A, dude.
It's been wild. It's been
absolutely.
It's been different than I thought it would be. Yep. You know, it's like, oh, do a podcast, and it's like, oh, we're just going to dick and fart, or it's going to be, like, amazing, and everyone's going to love it. And it's like, no, man, you kind of have to put a little effort into things you're saying or topics or,
yes,
you know, you jot things down. And I don't know, all of us we're a little different personality, each one of us, but it seems like our commonalities are all kind of aligned in the same. And it's like, it doesn't really matter what someone thinks in certain ways, it matters who they are and like what they do. Yeah. But it's fun to like push conversations because, yes, these are way more in depth than anything I normally do. Like, I get in a conversation at work and someone starts talking and it's so boring. I just drowned out instantly about just mundane stuff. If it's a
Seahawks. Dude, did you watch the latest episode of Meat Eater? And it's like, oh, God, shut up.
Well, hang on. That's me. It's profound.
I did, but come on, dude.
Yeah.
But it makes you really pursue or push big ideas, which never happens.
Yes.
You know?
It's sort of lost in modern society because everybody's staring. You know, we're talking about social media. People are staring at their phones, kind of scrolling, looking for, you know, 30 seconds at a time of interest in this and then interest in the next thing.
I do nothing if not push big ideas. You know what I mean? So I'm glad you guys brought me on.
You do, though.
So I think it's much more rare now in society for people to sit down and just have a long conversation. I intentionally...
It's kind of like car rides are nice. Going on, like, the American road trip is dead.
Yeah.
People don't do it like they used to, right? That was like a rite of passage for kids.
Now it's all podcast and audibles and...
Well, not even...
They've got their Game Boy in the back or their whatever.
Yeah, or just on your cell phone.
Being forced to be in a situation, it's like that's like the band of brothers for the modern day man used to be like the Chevy Chase family vacation. Going, enduring something together, going a large distance to a destination. Yep. It bonds you. And
all the kids are crying in the backseat. Yeah. Everybody's upset. And then at the end of the day, you're like, isn't everybody having fun? Everybody's like, fuck you. It's like, yeah, this is great.
I love you too.
Yeah, but like, you know, moving into my house and like kind of slowly getting everything in there, and I just kind of decided I'm not going to get a TV because the first weekend we were there, Zach and Christy were hanging out, and we're all just sitting around the living room, faced all the couches in toward the center so everybody looks at each other. And it was... I sort of realized this is the model. This is the way I want it to be, so that when people are here, everybody sits around, looks at each other, and talks.
Yeah. And so far, every time we've gone over there, that's exactly what happens.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
I love movies.
I love movies, too.
That's why I have that giant TV as soon as you walk in, and that thing swivels.
That's fair. I love it. Because Nathan and I, he's super excited about his dirt bike, and I was telling him about the Terminator 2 scene where John Connor's out running the T-1000 through the LA River on his XR100, and it's like, you know what, we need to watch Terminator 2. So it ended up being him and I, like, sitting on the couch trying to watch my iPad.
Which
it still ended up good. He's still, at the end of the movie, he's like, that was an awesome movie.
Oh,
like,
fucking yeah. That was. Have you ever had a really good surround sound system? Like, they used to be all the rage. People don't, everything seems like you said, I'll watch this on an iPad with my headphones. But life used to be about a sweet flat screen and a sweet surround sound.
The 1 year I went to college after high school, there was a friend of mine who lived like across the hall in the dorms who worked at like a Car Toys or whatever.
Yeah.
And so he bought himself a really fancy in-home stereo system. And I love the movie Heat.
Yeah,
and so
it's a good movie.
I would go over into his room and crank it up as loud as it would go and go to that final, you know, run and gun firefight at the end. And there's that scene had a large amount of influence on me joining the Army.
I believe it. Thanks, Val.
Yep. And that scene is actually, you know, for people who don't know, they're being tactically sound. Like, that scene holds up.
Cover
and fire. Like, they actually show them changing magazines instead of, like, the Schwarzenegger, unending belt of ammo. And
That is a good, going down all those cars, that's a great scene. Because it is a long shootout.
It's a long shootout.
Which makes it
freaking great.
Could you imagine being part of that? What was that, LA Bank? robbery where the guys had all the all armor on and stuff like that. Yep. That was like a 20-minute.
Except those guys weren't really trying to get away. They were just trying to wreak as much havoc as they could before they finally got done in.
That is true. But it was a long shootout. Did
nobody die in it or something like that?
They died.
Well, they died, but didn't.
And the city sued them.
I think a couple cops got wounded. I know a couple cops were wounded. I don't know if any died.
They died, and the mother of the victim sued the LAPD. For like $13 million or something nuts. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Fucking Grand Force Brooks Hatchet.
Which happens to be a great tool should the apocalypse happen.
That's what I was saying, dude.
Which is
it's so light.
Yeah.
It's trippy how light.
Oh, and what's crazy about those things, too, is for actually falling trees, like a 10-inch round tree, those things will eat right through. It's crazy. Well,
for a little
tiny hand. Yeah. Yeah.
And I took a couple whacks at it, and I was like, oh, shit.
Yeah, I saw you bend your saw. I felt bad. You're silky.
Oh. I'm an axe guy, not a saw guy. Come
on. First timer over here. Yeah. Where do you put the bar oil?
Oh, my God.
The hunting trip, that kind of proved to me that these were super legit.
These are.
Yeah.
Dude, these are nuts. Thank you. Very much. Honestly, you're welcome. Thank you. I deserve none of it. I'm such a degenerate. I'm right, I just like hanging out with like good people. Like people, they're like, here's an axe. I'm like, oh, man. Oh, I'm a dirtball. I got nothing for you. Such a bad person. But I provide friendship.
Yeah. Well,
you know what? You're closest to the podcast fluid. So how about hitting us a couple of...
yeah, no shit.
Oh, there we go. Thank you.
Hey, friend. Enjoy that.
There we go. I was trying to give you a soft lead into your apocalypse topic there, Mike, but you let that one fly right by you.
Oh, we had a... So this weekend, speaking of road trips, mm-hmm. I got a chance to take my nephew to a baseball tournament in Wenatchee this weekend. And we haven't had a lot of time together, so this was, like, super cool to be able to go out and spend time with him. And like you said, it's like, you know, you get the phone in front of the kid or video games or any of that. But like, he was so excited, I think, to go.
About
and
the game, the tournament?
No, just to be, I just felt like it was just Uncle to Jordan. Be, yeah.
Oh,
was
yeah, like, yeah.
That's so, that yeah. feels so cool.
Well, it's also like a good statement of character that also my kids really like hanging out with you guys. Like, they get excited about kickboxing on Saturday nights or just, like, I'll be like, hey, do you guys want to go out to the range this weekend? They're like, no. And I'm like, we're having breakfast with Mike and Jordan first. They're like, yeah.
Well, cause it's funny, too. Like, you brought up, like, the video game or the TV and stuff. And the boys guessed that it was a dirt bike.
Oh, yeah.
Because they were like, we knew you wouldn't buy us a fucking PlayStation.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I was like, I got a surprise for you guys. They're like, dirt bike? I was like, fuck. They're like, well, Dad, it's not like you're going to buy us a video game or something. Yeah. Like, all right.
Fair. Yeah, fair. Something you can get hurt on, dude. Yeah. Here you go. Let's go.
Exactly.
It was a cool weekend, and we went out and played some baseball, baseball in Wenatchee, and it was really cool. He ended up hitting a homer, like, you know, 11U, it's pretty impressive to smack a couple of those. So he's gotten two now.
Nice.
He's all jacked up. He's flexing. He's, you know, all jacked. Runs around, like, some kid grabs a ball, brings the ball back. His whole team goes out there. So it was a really cool moment to, like, be out there with him.
Yeah.
But as we were kind of hanging out that night, we're hanging around the hotel. And all the kids, you know, it's the whole hotel is just baseball.
Packed full of baseball kids. Yeah,
so it's like kids everywhere. So much urine in that
pool.
Oh, dude, yeah. They got in it. but, no, there was a guy, and we're sitting there bullshitting, and he kind of looks at me, and he recognized the voice a little bit, he said. He was like, wrestling, jiu-jitsu? I was like, yeah. And he was like, he was listening to Will's podcast.
Okay.
So he ends up knowing Will. and knows us through the podcast.
That's awesome.
Oh, no way.
So it was like, holy shit, what's going on, man?
So we both met a podcast fan this weekend.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think he's Will's podcast fan, but...
We'll poach him. Yeah, we'll claim it.
Shout out, Tony. Yeah. But apparently, Will, he was talking about Will a little bit, and Will went to the Little League World Series.
Yeah,
in Pennsylvania. I think there's layers to Will that we don't even know yet.
In Pennsylvania.
He just won't he won't disclose. We're gonna have to pry it out of him.
Yeah. We need to get him good and liquored up. Yeah.
That's why you gotta listen to the podcast.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, obviously when we do the one at the Korean barbecue, Will's gonna be that'll be a dual show again.
We're gonna drug him. Tell us the truth about you.
Yeah. He's the guy, he's the informant. Yeah.
It's Will this whole time. It's him who's been calling the FBI on me.
Our sleeper cell.
He's the embedded federal agent at Electric North. This whole time we've been thinking it was Kay.
Maybe Soju activates him. Maybe we shouldn't take him to the Korean barbecue.
He might beat us all up.
Yeah.
I don't want to deal with blacked out angry Will.
Oh, no way. Dude,
it's all right. I'll cheek a bunch of Beetle Nut and take him on. I'll absorb the power of the Beetle Nut.
Yeah.
And I mean.
Oh, my God.
Dude, and that I was asking that Tony guy about it, too. And he was like, yeah, oh, yeah.
Beetle Nut?
He goes, you chew it long enough, your spit turns red.
Yeah.
He's like, what?
Like permanently?
While you're chewing.
like a dragon.
Yeah. I was like, ah.
I still don't understand the point. Why can't you just put tobacco in your lip without Beetle Nut? And
it gives you a different effect. It makes it. It does, okay,
so the Beetle Nut itself has an effect.
Yeah,
it's not like just packing a walnut with tobacco.
it's like, why add a placebo to the tobacco?
It does something.
You're going to put it in an olive.
Yeah. Like a fucking pimento. That's
true. Yeah. You ever had any red man make your eyeballs sweat?
It was good, though. That Beetle Nut did something to it.
All right.
Yeah, that's
what. Or it was the Pall Mall.
Chewing on a Pall Mall was just.
That was a new one.
That was too much for me.
That was a new one.
That was too much for me because I was just like, I chewed it and I was like, okay, what am I supposed to do? Like, and Will, like, I am like, what am I, where's the instructions? And he was just kind of turned. Yeah. And just didn't
figure it out.
He was like, come on, dude. Like, do I suck on this thing? Like,
figure it out. What
am I? Oh, my God.
It was funny. I listened
And to what that. Was in the squirt bottle? Was it lime juice or Who coral knows? Or fucking sunscreen?
It said coral.
Coral? But they also said lime. It's both lime. Was it both?
Who knows?
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well, yeah, I guess we just need to do another episode at the Korean barbecue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hold the Beetle Nut.
I'll try the Beetle Nut this time.
Will you?
If I throw up, it's your fault.
It was funny. I listened to that episode. And Jordan nailed it. He's like, you know, at this stage in life, there's not a lot of doing firsts. Just looking at that Beetle Nut cigarette. Like,
dude.
He kept saying, this is wild. That was hilarious.
Oh, my God.
That was fun. That was a good night.
Yes.
What was one of the first? Well, I guess the first one was at our house or my house.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was
the introduction.
That was a rough one because
what do you mean?
Everyone was a little clammed up. Nobody, we didn't really have a solid plan.
Yeah, but introducing yourself is still
always
rough.
Awkward.
You tell us to do an introduction now, and it's like, whoa.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Oh, but we have an idea of what's going on.
True.
A little bit more.
Yeah.
Now,
just fill time with rant and babble.
You know what I've always
but
wanted
then
to
here's,
do?
Here's the other thing is episode 2, which was our backcountry hunting with Jake. I'm sorry, Jordan. Go ahead.
Is get interrupted by Tobin again. And that's why I love coming on here.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
What I was going to say is episode 2 is one of the most downloaded episodes. Like I can pull up like the total downloads. And so that number 2 episode where we did backcountry hunting loadout with Jake, which was, again, the idea that sort of spawned the whole thing, is still one of our most popular episodes, even a year later.
I think the tags matter. I think hunting matters. We haven't done like a soul hunting. We've done like 2 or 3 of them. But the hunting, really trying to get on it before
deer. We kind of did a hunt one.
We could do one on turkey. Part of me wants to bring this out.
Bring your car and a tent and a shotgun.
Well,
and a decoy.
Well, I'm talking about bringing this out to turkey camp.
Oh.
And then just run.
I got a little whisper generator.
Same, yeah. We could just run a long extension cord and do that from camp.
That's a good idea.
As the fire crackles.
Sorry, Brent. I'm going to tell you that ahead of time, man. There will be some profanity. You kidding me?
If we do that, we might have to put Nathan on the fourth mic.
Oh, there you go.
With earmuffs? I can't say that.
He's heard it all.
I'll push him.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be fun. It'd be a fun night. Yeah. Even if it doesn't end up working out, it'd be still fun to do. So let's do it.
Could be the next deleted episode that nobody Patreon. Gets to hear.
Yeah. Well, what I think would be kind of fun is to start doing like a little segment every show. Whoa. Who did that come from? And that's what we'll call it.
That's a microphone.
What segment?
I don't know, just trying to start figuring out little things. So like
you pitching like a subject,
would you rather the Seinfeld? Would you rather thing, right? Like you're talking about you had a bunch of would you rathers.
I was thinking we could just like situation. If you guys get a
yeah, but just
we,
like
could,
having,
we could pop Jordan's back pimples on OnlyFans.
Well, that's not just a segment. That's how I make money.
That's primary income.
And then I sell the pus.
Yeah, I'll let you guys in on that.
Yeah. And I'll use panties.
Yeah. Yeah.
His Amazon wish list is just underwear that he wears and sells again. Yeah. I'm rich. How do you think I'm buying this kitchen?
Yeah, I wear a new pair every day, dude. It's business, okay? It's business. Yeah. Why do you think I go into the bathroom after jiu-jitsu? Yeah.
Good.
I have to switch them up.
You got
to
get them off, get them in a Ziploc bag, kind of seal them in. Yeah, I got to
fucking seal them in quick. Products are quality from me, dude.
Yep.
Gross.
Yep.
No thanks.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, only holes.
So whoa. 1 year, huh?
Oh, God damn
it. Yep, same. What were you? I'm very curious now.
Yeah, Mike has a notepad with notes.
Yeah.
And I keep looking over at you waiting for you to.
That's why I was like, segments, hey.
We're giving homage. We're giving homage to our 1 year.
Normally when we bring notepads in here, they're full of blank pages. When Jordan and I show up, and by the end of the podcast, we've got like 3 to 5 words.
Yeah,
a couple wieners. You've got an entire page over there, and I keep kind of looking over at it like, what's he got over there?
Just a part. Well, like you were saying, our best episode was the gear one with Jake. I think we all joke, we're like, haha, Jordan's slow, you know? Jordan can't read, you know? We'd make all these funny jokes. But I think
about
we're
Jordan.
Truly, not the dog.
Jordan's dick's so big, dude.
But I think we're holding him back. The backpacking gear episode is what does the most. And he's like, let's talk about gear and become millionaires. And I'm like, dude, time's crazy. Yeah. And we're throttling him, you know? And
is this where you guys kick me off? No. Hey, we brought you here today, bud. You just gave me a fucking axe. And you wanna,
see ya. You wanna do this? Kick rocks, dude. Take your axe.
Oh, man.
But, like, that was one of our biggest episodes. And then I think so was our apocalypse one. Yes, our, like our get home bag.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
And so it's like, gear. let's give.
And the disaster prep with Brent one was also is in the top five.
Right? Yeah. We keep throttling this poor soul.
This poor guy.
Yeah.
But he keeps talking about his gear review channel that he's going to do, and it never happens. So I'm,
I
want to push you to get
back at him. I got a fucking podcast I'm trying to talk on. You know?
I get stuck talking about time and fucking
reading books.
Reference frames. Actual frames.
The
relativity.
Divine Matrix, yeah.
Yeah, the Divine Matrix.
Exactly. I'm over here memorizing facts that I can't rememorize. bringing in shitty facts over here. And I'm just, you know.
Really just wants to talk about chromoly steels.
Yeah, I just want to, you know, I just want to talk about how sharp shit can get and what you can do with it.
We're holding them back. And so in that nature, I want to go for a classic 1 year episode of not throttling Jordan and go with our
massaging Jordan.
Yeah. Let's massage him to due north in the right direction. And I wanted to do like an apocalypse kind of one. So last time was just like a random, like, what was it, gear bag? What's your plan? How are you going?
We didn't have a plan when we showed up, but we fell very quickly into the get home bag because that ended up filling up a whole episode, which was awesome.
So I wrote down just a couple, maybe like 6 or 7 just questions.
Just six or seven pages.
Apocalypse questions. they're kind of out of order. And you want to know how much research, you know how much I care for this podcast. You know how many old white guys on YouTube I had to be listening to laying out the scenario of the big one to get some actual interesting, like to pick through it and be like, oh, that's a good question.
No.
About 40 minutes, but
40, yeah. I nailed it.
So here we go.
There's a few clicks in there, though.
Yeah. Okay. Let's say this is the first one. We'll lay the groundwork of the end.
Yeah, lay it. Okay. Right. Lay it down.
You hear of impending doom. It could be disease, asteroid, or war of invasion.
Yep.
Something, they're just chatters crazy. Work, they're kind of like, hey, you know what? Next week, let's not come in. It's kind of like the COVID thing, but it seems more real.
Yeah.
What?
I didn't get a day off.
I almost didn't go to work because of the eclipse.
You guys are working during the apocalypse, just framing, running wire.
They'll be like, this schedule says you have to have this energized by next week.
8 weeks? Fuck you.
It's crazy. He showed up for 3 more weeks after the apocalypse and finished his job. I mean, it looked good.
Yeah.
So you hear of impending doom. What is your plan? Are you going to bug in? Are you going to start to bug out? Are you going to separate yourself and kind of just narrow it down to a few specifics?
That's so hard to get specific on based on different scenarios. Because
we're shutting down the gear guy instantly. Look at
that. No, what I'm saying.
I need yes and.
Primary plan is to bug in.
Okay.
Bug out is you bug in because that's where you're going to be most comfortable and you have food, water, shelter if you're smart. You should have food, water, shelter prepared for several, I would say several months in your own home. However, that bug in plan can become untenable pretty quickly because not everybody prepares. So you end up with, great case studies like Leningrad, where the Nazis laid siege to the city of Leningrad, no food, no material, no energy supplies. Like they couldn't get heating oil, couldn't get food. So pretty quickly, and really all across the Eastern Front, just because war comes with famine and
consumes
and lack, basically lack of energy, lack of food, lack of necessities. So very quickly that Eastern steppe was overrun, but was rife with sort of roving bands of bandits who were both killing and robbing, just basically trying to stay alive. So lots of murder, rape, and pillaging immediately follows any sort of conflict.
Yeah.
Because you end up with a lawless region that is bereft of necessities.
So if finances weren't really a problem, say you had another piece of property, say it's in Montana, it's in Idaho, it's way more rural. If you started hearing of impending doom coming and you lived in this fantasy, would you stay here for now or would you immediately head over as an exit? You know,
are we saying that piece of property is built up like there's infrastructure there? Or is it
you're in the woods, you have a cabin, you got solar, you got gas generator.
If you have a way to like be kind of bugged in and out at the same time, like a cabin, of course.
Yeah.
But like if all of a sudden we're like living our day-to-day lives and we're at home doing our normal day-to-day thing and you start hearing kind of stuff on the like things are starting to happen, I think first off, you would definitely want to make sure all the shit that you have for such an occasion is in the same room, accessible, maybe not necessarily in your garage, but like in your
living room area.
Yeah. So you're ready to rock. You got to get some totes. and basically, you're getting ready for a hunt. You're getting ready for a hunt. Right. Yeah. So you pack like you're going on a trip for like hunting and you have all your stuff dialed and but it's just going to be more. You're going to start maybe parking your truck backwards instead of forwards. You know what I mean? You're going to do little things like that to change your habits or maybe you start doing them now and just be ready for that. So that habit is a habit.
Yes.
But like the things like that, you start hearing this stuff, you need to make sure all your shit's dialed, all your stuff's ready to go. The gas is where it needs to be. You got gas, you know, you start putting all that shit together. And then if nothing happens, you're now up and you're a little bit more prepared for the next week. Yeah. But the reality is you just got to tighten up all the shit that you have and ready to go. Then you just got to start talking. Communication is number one, right? You got to start, hey, what are you hearing? What are you hearing? And then you go, what are we going to do?
Yeah.
If this,
the other thing I think that gets missed is a lot of people think about this as an individual plan, and human beings don't survive as individuals.
Exactly.
Because you're going to run into a band of Greg and Toby and Jordans who have realized that there's...
And Mike's.
Michael, well, he's going full
I'm going to have my own people.
Mike's fucking communist regime. Yeah, we're gonna be at war.
My sea of blue-haired minions will fuck you guys over.
Okay. Yeah.
So a couple things are going to happen.
Try and block the freeway.
Which is that there's a lot of people...
Your gender will be in compromised status.
There are so many people who are not prepared for even a 2-week shortage of food that very quickly you're going to have. In so going back to your question, do you get out into rural areas? If you have the infrastructure to get into a rural area and also have a community there, like a community of people who are also prepared and able to defend their preparations, that's best case scenario. But none of us have that. So let's talk about bugging in at our own houses. Pretty fast, you're going to have desperation set in because most people are not prepared for 2 weeks without food, let alone 2 weeks without running water or some of these other scenarios. And so there's going to be a lot of death, just people, famine, pestilence, disease, right? America is rife for a massive die-off of pestilence because people are so unhealthy. So the moment that all our sanitation, like we have all this sanitation, we have prescription drugs. The moment the sanitation and the prescription drugs are gone, these people are going to start dropping like flies.
Well, you're going to start having crazies running around. You're also going to see a lot of people all of a sudden get a little bit healthier.
Well, think about if the fentanyl supply stopped. Think about how insane people would go down in Seattle.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think that, and maybe it would move 30 miles up to us. You know,
so my thought, honestly, the best thing to do is you take, because we have a group of people who are motherfuckers, is we load up a convoy Mad Max style with all of our non-perishable food,
even the
cold weather supply. Yeah. Even the perishable.
I mean,
supplies.
We're bringing everything.
Yeah.
We're going to look like fucking.
Yeah. Load up some box trucks, steal some box trucks, load them up, bring everybody, just go to the nearest gated community that's on a hill.
I mean,
barge in and say, here. Hey, guess what? We live here now and you don't. And that's the reality of a survival situation.
Except her. She stays.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Okay, hang on.
No.
Because you're starting to go down a couple rabbit holes.
But hang on. What that also points out is that you cannot bug in by yourself. You have to have community defense.
Yeah.
Because there are going to be roving bands of people who are armed and who, as they approach desperation, become capable.
So
every human being is 12 missed meals away from being capable of murder.
If this scenario is one of which that's like the grid's
shit's,
down,
there, shit's
we're not
just hitting
we're
the
not
fan.
We're not being invaded. Like if we're not being invaded, because that brings a whole different fucking you know. So because that's too broad. Right, so say it's a situation where we're not being invaded.
Let's use total grid collapse.
How about we're not being invaded yet? Because a grid down or something is a form of invasion. We're not invaded yet, but shit's
hitting. We're saying no foreign soldiers on the soil.
Yeah,
we're saying total grid down.
Yeah,
something.
Which they're here already.
Maybe even there's rumors of bombings.
Yeah, that's true.
Bombing suicide bombers, people from within. It's starting to fall apart.
If it was stuff like that, if it was like a terrorist attack.
Suicide bombers, you still have... functional infrastructure.
If it was a terrorist attack,
yes, but
to take down the grid.
Yes.
That's where we're going.
But
we're
this is a
down.
Huge world war. This is the apocalypse. This
All right,
is
Mike,
China
give us a scenario.
Okay. We have technically China with incels moving people up. They want to destroy the United States. This big plan happens. The grid goes down. You start activating people that have been released into the United States. Russia keeps working over Ukraine, starts working through the Europe, and they do EMP. Maybe some people do some nuclear bombs. Maybe we're not hit yet. It's not World War III where everyone's blasting. Maybe there are bombs going off, and everything's kind of just going unhinged.
I don't think a state actor would take down the grid.
So...
That makes no sense. Why would you want to conquer territory that's now unusable? You want the infrastructure intact.
You got enough people from China. You can build it now.
You have to completely restart.
But you need to get rid of the people. Because America's full of armed citizens, you have to get rid of the people. You need a mass die-off and a mass... To minimize their casualties, let's maximize American casualties. So after all of that,
are we back to grid down? Yeah. Did he take us? Did he argue with us? Take us on a big roundabout to come back to grid down?
Yeah. Okay. So they shut down the grid.
Yeah.
because what the Chinese doing, did it. Okay. But so they did it with a remote control.
Give me that axe back.
Chops my fucking cord.
Yeah. That's the equivalent of putting out the fucking tiki torch.
Yeah. yeah.
Like Survivor. Yeah. It's podcast Survivor.
Yeah, so if that's the case and the grid goes down and there's no communication, and then all of a sudden we start hearing explosions and shit, the trestle is not there anymore, or the Everett's just got blown up, or
dams got blown.
Yeah, and we're starting to see it, but then like our communication would be absolutely zapped.
I was just going to say, first step is to bug in and attempt to establish communications.
And I think that, yeah, exactly. So that ends up either that or bug in or take the quick drive 25, because we're not, it's not like we're, if we're at home when this happens, if it's like in the evening, which why wouldn't it be in the middle of fucking day?
You got your night vision on and your AR-15 and the power goes out.
I'd like to have some night vision on.
We're working on it. Yeah. We're working on it.
We need that Patreon. We gotta start to...
Tell you what, dude. I'm going to give this back, and I expect it the 2 year.
the thing is like in that situation, you would have to put together your team. So you'd have to know who your team is already.
Yep. Yeah.
Right. So that's kind of the nice thing that we have here of like the reality of the situation, right? Like everybody's like, we're fucking
because when electronic communications fail, the next thing you need is a rally point, and we all know what the rally point is.
Yes,
right.
I think
my house. Come save Mike. Protect him. Human shield enacted. Okay, hang on. So we're talking. We would bug in. What point would you bug out? What would make it be like around other than like a nuclear bomb went off in Everett? You're like, I got to get the fuck out of here now.
If it like, becomes a security situation where again, roving bands of people just living in desperation,
even or blue if, helmets fucking starting to come through.
Or if the sanitation, like again, because we do live in some, like Jordan and I live just in neighborhoods. We're not in like
plague kicks up.
Exactly. Yeah. And you may have to get away from the pestilence.
Okay.
My situation right now is I'm on.
Just think of the smell of the think about how many people would die in Seattle and in the Puget Sound area, and think of the smell and the rotten bodies. Because you're not going to be able to bury them.
That's fucking true.
That takes time.
Give it a year.
They will recycle it
the
quickly.
The disease will go away.
Oh yeah, the bug out plan doesn't need to last more than a year and a half, I think.
The rats are going to eat people. Yes. They're going to get super disease infested. So they will push out. Maybe it does spread disease to rural areas.
What's important like for all of that to actually work is to have food and that kind of shit, right?
Yep. Renewable.
And the reality is
chickens.
Like you're going to have chickens. You're going to have, I mean, that is kind of the thing, right? Like you're only going to be able to hunt squirrels for so long.
Yeah.
But those chickens make noise and that's a beacon to somebody else who's hungry.
Which means you're going to have ammunition and
you need to have a community and a defense plan.
Yeah. No, you disable the rooster's vocal cords.
Yeah. You perform
just a small,
you perform 13 to 14 small surgeries,
small incisions. Very narrow.
Yeah. Very narrow slit.
Gender reassignment on your rooster.
Yeah. Where's my beer?
But then, like, so if that's the case and you're, like, you're working on these different situations to have feed, but then you need to be able to feed those things.
You can if leave they're them, free range, they're going to be able to eat bugs. The chickens can sustain themselves very well.
Chickens are pretty capable.
But you wanna know a sweet
you're
going
to lose
trick?
Them due to predators more likely than more they free range.
Little fucking trick here.
Tell me.
A 5-gallon bucket, holes drilled in the bottom of it. You start killing those predators that want to eat them, right?
They always kill them when I'm not there, though.
Yeah, but where else are you going to be?
sleeping. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Livestock required defense.
You're going to have to
have people around. But that's where you need
dogs. Well, dogs.
But then dogs are allowed.
And dogs require food. Dogs are going to require some food. And that, that's true. Right? So you gotta be ready to fucking shoot some. So if you have more people, you're on chicken duty, dude. Yes. You're the chicken guardian.
You will literally have to have sentries out. You'll have to have 2 to 3 people out on guard all the time.
Roving fucking
Depending
guys.
On the amount of space your little community takes up, you have to have guards out.
But anyway, back to the chicken hack. Take and kill whatever predator or rats or whatever. 5-gallon bucket, holes drilled in the bottom, just toss it in there. Let it rot. Flies come, lay larvae in it. Yeah. Larvae fall through there. Chickens eat the larvae.
Oh, gross.
That's disgusting.
It's good, though.
Yeah,
fuck yeah. I'm telling you, dude.
I got all this raw hamburger in the chicken coop. I'm like, Daniel, stay away. It's for them.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so I think we determined
when things go nasty like that, you can do get creative.
I think that is genius, though. I've seen chicken feeders where they do rot stuff like that and get larvae to lay on meat, and they give it fresh to the chickens, and it's like fresh chicken larva. Muscle milk. Yep. Well, you know, it creates grade A.
I've seen little like troughs that they build, and they put dirt in there, and then they have little tubes coming up out of the totes or whatever.
Yeah.
And as whatever's in there rots and larvae start trying to crawl out, they'll go towards the air.
Yeah.
And they'll work their way out of these things. And then they just drop down into a little bucket and get
chicken feeder, huh?
A little chicken feeder.
Goddamn.
All right, boys. We're continuing this apocalypse. So we decided we're bugging in.
Bugging in for sure.
It's
a very complicated explanation, but it's a grid down scenario.
Well, it has to. See, it deserves real thought. We have to
bugging
debate.
In, but then at that point you're checking rally points and trying to find, you know.
We're doing all that.
Yeah, you're
the
checking
whole gamut. So now we're here. We're doing it.
Uh huh.
Rating houses. What are you going for first?
Specialty.
Are you going for food?
The virgins.
Are you going for ammunition? And mind you, a lot of ammunition and toys of that nature are going to be locked in safes. How do we deal with safes?
Not a problem.
Also, raiding houses. I thought it would be like Peleliu harvesting, like getting gold teeth. It's like, can't wait to break in, bust a door on another house and raid it. I thought that would be fun. Also, it's like...
Mike
just goes feral and he's just out. He's just in it for the killing.
Also, I thought it would be like Apocalypse Antique Roadshow. Like, you're just garage sailing everywhere.
Oh, yeah. Dude, I mean, that's the thing. It's like,
I can't wait to make my Mad Max vehicle.
Yeah. Oh, dude. I mean,
we're getting there. Don't worry. All right.
And if it was an EMP situation and cars were down.
Yeah.
And we had to do all these raids on bicycles.
Oh,
like,
shit.
You know? coming for you.
Playing cards in the spokes. Yeah. Do you hear that?
Yeah. They're coming.
It's the electric They're North
coming.
Gang.
They're coming. You got a fucking beer can over the tire crushed on it.
Like, oh, my God. On Friday when Debo's riding that bike, it's like,
Yeah, so depending on the situation, if it was like a grid down collapse versus in a EMP, like if an EMP happened and we had no communication with radios or anything
Nova
like
would
that,
run.
That Nova would run.
We
got to
get
fine.
We got to get the distributor out of the oven though.
No. It's,
so you're
I,
looking
you don't think
for,
I got two of those?
So transportation's a big one immediately though.
They say pre 1980 cars and Jeeps and trucks will run no problem.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, how about?
Hang on. Here's another point to that, though, is that as people panic and things devolve, how many abandoned cars are like, think of gridlock on the freeway and then people just start getting out of their cars and leaving them. There's no guarantee that the roads
are going to be absolutely that. And that's why I think it's important to have old
dirt bikes. Yeah.
Okay. No.
Yeah.
So that brings up a good point. Like,
and
there might be a
cheap.
Big emphasis
on that. That's true. That Honda XR is still going to kick over.
Yep.
Even after an EMP.
But transportation of a car, it's going to be hard when.
How long are you going to be able to get gasoline?
Exactly.
There's going to be a lot of cars.
So, but hang on. What about, like you said, there's going to be a lot of currency in bicycles, horses, llamas for packing. Yeah. Like you said, pre-80s, fucking pre-1900s. If the apocalypse is real and we're bugging in, we need to go on a pony raid, boys.
Yeah, so actually, so right, this is even bikes need maintenance.
This is
horses,
gonna,
might, you, you know, horses,
you mules, breed them and you shoot yeah. them and then you eat them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I've said it a couple times, I think, on this, but the going to the 1900s with tools and getting tool heavy and just having, first of all, they look cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they still work. Like this is the oldest fucking axe making company in the world.
Yeah.
Right? They were in like, I think like 14 or 16 something. This is when this company started making the same fucking thing.
Yeah.
So the nothing fact that changed. There are things that like you just don't improve on. Yeah. So turn of the century, like there's plows, there's all those different shit. There's all kinds of like there's literal like barber shop, like what are those clippers?
Oh yeah.
You can the hand clippers. Yeah. Like there's things like that we can have for so cheap right now. And it's like, why do you need it? And it's like, I don't know. But if the power ever goes out, I can give myself a fucking haircut.
Yeah.
Like, but there's places that are antique stores all over the place that are like, people look at old shit and they're like, oh, that's kind of cute or that's cool looking, but like.
So yeah. You think like if the apocalypse happened, your raiding party, you get us and you're leading the raiding party, you would be more inclined to go out to maybe a little bit more rural area somewhere with a barn that the families have died.
I was going to say food and tools are the two things I'd be looking for if we were raiding.
I think barn's
more likely to have food, ammo, people into canning, maybe.
Ammo, food. I mean, food is number one. What keeps you alive first? Yeah. Go. You work your way up the fucking hierarchy. Yep.
Food, water, shelter.
Food, water, shelter. Tarps, tents.
Yeah, but
wood.
And tools are a mean to all those things.
Yes.
If you have tools, you can start providing a lot of those things for yourself. Those
burn energy.
You get ingenious.
If you saw a nice house where the people died, would you take it over or would you try and stay in your house?
It depends.
Of course. Without question.
Yeah.
Without
question.
Bubble bath.
The infrastructure too. Like, my house has a generator and a septic tank. So it's a great, and a lake across the street for water. So it's a great spot.
Is your septic gravity or pump fed?
Pump.
So then
eventually the propane runs out. So it is, you're right. It is a short term plan.
I think my shit is downhill.
You got a gravity fed, which is nice.
I think.
Actually, I do live on a hill. Maybe mine is gravity. I should.
If it was, it would be going right into the fucking
lake. Into the lake. Well, no, I know the front yard is the drain field, so it is running downhill.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, I mean, I think
don't eat the fish, boys.
Yeah. Yeah. Catch them, release.
Catch and release.
Yeah, I think there's tools that you want to have.
Yeah.
But I think having ammunition is probably the number one tool you're going to need. And the first, but it all depends, right? The first year.
No, I agree. I think it's important.
The first thing you want to grab is tools to protect yourself.
Tools
to outlast the other people. So food that's non-perishable, food that's perishable, ammunition to protect said food.
So what about that? I said it earlier. A lot of toys, what we consider toys and the ammo that go to them, would be in safes. How would we break into safes? Say we're raiding houses.
Broco torch.
A what?
Broco, like a cutting torch, a welder's
like
cutting
a acetylene
torch.
And those two.
Back to we need tools.
Yeah, that doesn't take anything but
I have cutting. It. But I didn't think it's... I've never tried to go through steel.
There's a company called Fifth Ops, and you can buy those torches that are basically like flares. So you take them. And
I've seen them for locks.
Oh, shit.
And you take for locks, you can take they melt them out.
It's like a one-time use kind of deal.
Yeah, so
it's like pure magnesium.
They work for 20 minutes, I think. So you can...
If you ever shove one of those up a bullfrog's ass?
And...
He'd be barbecued and stuff, deep fried somehow.
Eat it. But I mean, having something like that to where it's like, oh, this is a heavy tool that in case I need to get through a gate.
You also don't need a shitload of guns. I don't know that you're going to be cutting into gun safes. You need like a rifle per person.
Yeah, no, ammo. But there's also other people. as the community grows, it's like, oh,
there's going to be so much die-off that stuff like that is going to be laying around. I think actually what
just
gets...
Just kick a 1911 as you walk into Walmart.
They say in one month with no power, 90% of the people.
Yes. And that's not us making that up. That's like from FEMA.
Yeah. Which is the same place you need to have fucking 3 days worth of food at all times.
Yep.
And water.
And I think something that does not get ever talked about when people are talking about apocalypse or doomsday plans is everybody is so bent on how do I survive for 5 years? And it's like, well, really what you need to do is survive for 90 days. And then you need to think about how you're going to reestablish a community, because that's the key to moving forward. You don't want to live in this sort of like, we're all opposed to each other. We're all sort of sneaking around in the woods trying to kill each other and living like it's fucking Hunger Games. You want to survive 90 days until the week die off, and then you want to reestablish some sort of a community.
Ideologies at that point matter.
My clan.
Quite often.
Yeah. So Mike Zedong
We
rises.
Fucking drown Mike Zedong day one. Day one.
Yeah. Checks out.
Well, at least I'll have sweet night vision.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think if we just like make him eat all the beetle nut, we can change
him.
We can convert him.
We can change him.
He forever spit red.
We'll just keep him. Yeah, sorry. We'll keep him chained to a post high on beetle nut. He'll be like our idol.
His eyes burned with fury. I'm feeling it. Okay. So, well, we talked about the safe rating and stuff.
How would you, because you kept asking about how to get in a safe.
Yeah.
How would you get in a safe?
I think cut it, drill it. Like, if you still had kind of power tools, if you could get a drill, right, and just drill a hole all the way through the top or the bottom where it doesn't have the thickness of the doors, and get your Sawzall and hope 4 batteries gets you through it. And if it doesn't...
You got your apocalypse Sawzall batteries?
Yeah, yeah. And if it doesn't, that's where it's like, get the torch, get the rock pry bar, get the crowbar. I'm getting in this fucker.
Daniel, did you use this fucking battery on the leaf blower last week? I told you not to.
Yeah.
Babe, all my guns are in here.
Well, I mean, that's...
That's another point is EMP. A lot of our safes are electric. Keep one rifle out of your safe.
Okay, so that leads me into my next question. Say it's not our fantasy apocalypse where there's guns laying on the street left and right. Say the apocalypse happens, you have one weapon. What would it be?
Ruger 10/22.
Yeah. Dork. Next question.
I would go with a bolt gun or a pump something just because they're really low maintenance.
Oh, you're out of control, dude. You're going to die. You got one weapon. You got a fucking bolt gun.
Yeah, I would go with a bolt gun.
5.56.
I'm going AR. AR all day.
High maintenance, bitch. So now you got to... That's not a bad choice, but you do have to make sure you've stockpiled some lubricant.
But you also have to think. If
it's, come on, dude.
Yeah.
Come on, dude.
You know what I got
planned. I live right down the street from Costco.
Dude, what's that self-lubricating gun?
Dude, they got tri-tip in here for like, you can get like 13 pounds of tri-tip. You want in on this?
Dude, I was so excited.
I know you were.
Oh, dude, I was 19. but yeah, and they also have KY jelly like you wouldn't believe.
No shit.
Oh, yeah.
Damn.
Does it have a pump? Yeah. Here's a real determining factor if you're getting enough lube. Oh.
Yeah, dude.
Do they?
I've been making so many balloon animals.
With your wiener?
Magnum. Yeah, dude.
Yeah. Remember that, what was it, puppetry of the penis?
No.
You guys don't remember? No?
What are you talking
Show
about?
Us.
Dude. Yeah,
Prove it.
You want to see the snail shell, the conch shell? Dude, these guys would go, and they would form their... Dude, auditoriums filled with everyone, like old women, dudes, everything, and it was called puppetry of the penis. They would pull it out, but they would create weird shapes, and like it was molded.
What the fold fuck?
It. Dude, it was super popular. How have you never heard of this?
Just an excuse to pull your dick out in front of people.
Yeah, what weird hippie
I've fucking... been doing it for years. Yeah, I'm an artist. It's dick puppetry. Yeah. Except my art.
Yeah. He's going to pull out old fucking like pamphlets and flyers of like Mike.
Back in the day.
Yeah, the real magic Mike.
If you see this man near a school.
Yeah. Do you kids want a puppet show? FBI like kicks in the door.
We got him.
Yeah. Okay, so Tobin's out of control.
The Diglett.
I don't think...
I'm not the one pulling out my dick.
I don't think... Well, you should be, because you're using a bolt gun in the apocalypse. Yeah. Might as well have it in the wind. Yeah. That seems crazy.
No, I...
Hang on. I say that because I'm sitting here thinking about different scenarios, but the real answer is the gun that's standing by ready to go is an AR.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so
and it's versatile.
So yeah. my
I could kill an elk with an AR.
If it was...
Of course you could.
Yeah. If I didn't have to, like... You could kill a elk with a 22. It's been done.
10-22.
Been done.
Like right in the eyeball?
Maybe.
You shoot him in the leg.
Maybe right in the head. And then you hit it in the skull, and then it just bounces around in there and turns his skull or his brain into Swiss cheese.
See?
Nah.
Duh.
10-22. You guys?
How's that build going?
Have
you cleaned it yet?
I took it out and I looked at it the other day. Perfect. I'm like, am I taking this turkey hunting?
We should bring him.
We should.
That would be fun. I'll bring planking.
But the, I think a bolt gun is obviously like
it's nice for like long distance. Yeah. If I really want to shoot, if like I need a sniper guns, in my
like,
group,
like that Ruger Scout gun. That it's like a.
That's what I'm saying. A box barrel. Magazine.
Yeah, they're sweet, but it's
308
heavy ammo.
Yeah,
you're not going to get a ton of like.
Well, I think Tobin does give validity towards the bolt gun, but I think it's only if you're working in a group setting. Like to be like
yeah, again, the apocalypse if you happens. If you give me three trained men against three untrained men, and we have bolt guns and they have semi-autos, we're going
to
win.
Yeah, but it would be nice to have a sniper in the group. Like, if I have a crew, if it's me by myself, first thing I'm going to reach for, AR.
Sure.
It seems versatile. Yes. If it's the end of the world, I could probably salvage parts from other guns and stuff. Be able
to, it's the
or
most,
get another one. Versatile.
Like I said, they'll be laying around.
An AR.
If it comes down to the point where you need them, there will be a few laying around.
I can find parts.
We are probably, within a square mile of here, there are probably...
There's 100. More guns than people in the United States.
I'd say there's probably 100 within a square mile up here.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's like probably a realistic.
That's true. It is the one platform that will have the most spare parts laying around.
Every house has a couple ARs where I guarantee you.
Same like my neighborhood as well.
Yeah. You can shoot here, people.
But one of the things I love about my neighborhood is there's a lot of like In God We Trust and the Second Amendment, everything else. You know what I mean? Like a lot of that kind of shit in people's front windows. And it's like, it's a good spot.
Yeah, it's nice to know that people have that mentality because you'd also hope that that mentality carries over into, like, maybe we won't have to have chaos up here.
Yes.
Maybe everybody can just keep to themselves and you good? Yeah, I'm good. Are you? Okay.
And that's where, like, what Brent was saying, like, having, you know, reaching out to your neighbors beforehand, getting to know your neighbors. So, because, again, you're going to need community defense. It's not enough to be a lone wolf. You won't make it as a lone wolf.
Yeah. Well, and that's where I think a bolt gun would be nice. Like I was saying, being solo.
This fucking gaslighting motherfucker.
I know. He just told me it wasn't.
Yes. It's not.
Only
as
it's
my
22.
Go-to. As my, well, you're making a good point. My go-to would be to grab the AR. If I could only have one gun, I personally would take one gun.
Are you going 5.56? You going 308?
5.56 for weight.
Wait,
I can still reach pretty decent, but it's not going to be as heavy. Because
you can have a 22 AR too.
Yeah, and I the Elk Slayer over here.
That's what it sounds like.
Swiss cheese, one might say. But having a sniper in like an apocalypse situation would be nice. Someone that can reach out 500, 600 yards very effectively.
Yeah. And anybody can do that with an AR and a 6 power scope.
Yep.
600 yards is very easily attainable.
True, but I mean.
I mean, you got a hunting rifle, right? We all got hunting rifles.
We all have hunting rifles. And 600 yards is very attainable with any one of our hunting rifles.
Yes.
Yeah. So like a 270 with, you know. Yep. Whatever
10x scope on it.
Yeah, you're set. I think. I mean, who knows? Who fucking knows, right? Yep. If in the reality of the situation, like how many people can make that 600-yard shot?
Not a lot.
Not a lot, but you know what?
Get out and practice, boys.
Yeah, take some shots. Like there's right now. We should buy ammunition. It is a and this is just a
anybody who's listening to this, and if it comes out next week, or is it coming out this Friday? The whatever the this weekend.
It'll post this Friday.
Magazine ban in Washington has been lifted for a certain amount of time. So if that's something you need, obviously,
go get some.
Get a few. Put a priority on that, and then until the election, you need to be buying ammunition, right? That's something that just should be in a weekly budget or a monthly budget, is some sort of a way to acquire ammunition. If not to just have it around, it's, I mean, if you don't use it.
You're like Scarface.
Yeah, it just smells good.
On your table.
You should just be.
What is this, 5.56? Yeah.
If you're going to go use it, right, you can go train with it, or you don't have to train with it and you have it. Right, so either way, you're gonna have it, but the government's trying to fucking put a stop to that.
Which tells you everything you need to know
in a real way right now. Yeah. So they want to get rid of being able to buy bulk ammo, and they want to get rid of like being able to buy ammo online, and you have to go to an FFL, and who knows what they're trying to do, some fucking wait period or some weird shit. This is not real. I've never heard this, but it's not unforeseeable to think that they would try and make things even harder to do, even just as simple as buying ammunition.
Yeah.
Right. So, and then put a crazy tax on it. Like they're trying to put like 1,000% tax on it.
So how much would a box of like 50 rounds of 223, just like 50, a shooting? 50,
or so it, like a box of 20 right now is like $15, $9.99 is what it should be. Right.
Yeah.
For 20. What they're trying to do is make that $90.
Whoa. No, thank you.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, so hang on. A 36-cent round, I believe $30. Times 1,000 would be $360.
No.
So what's 1,000?
Percent. Oh, divide. Not times. Divide
$30. It would be a $30 round.
$360.
Okay. We're athletes, not mathletes.
All right. So imagine if every 5.56 round costs $3.50.
Yeah.
Every time you pulled the trigger.
Yeah. It's like shooting a 300 Win Mag.
Yeah, exactly.
Instantly. Yeah.
I kept saying $30. I'm over here with fucking conviction.
I used a calculator.
Yeah. My 1 year crew.
Yep.
Okay.
Hang on. Can we take a little break to drain some
podcast fluid? Yeah. I was going to say we've done a lot
rolling.
Already.
We're rolling.
We're going.
What time we got?
We're at an hour 13.
Oh,
we're nailing
let's
it.
Let's take a break.
We're taking a break. And now back to Jordan's Gun Corner with your host, Jordan the Dog.
We got to make a little correction there. The gun ban, apparently, this is today is...
magazine ban.
Yeah, magazine ban, but April 8th. So apparently a Cowlitz County judge ruled the Washington State high-capacity magazine ban unconstitutional. So when he did that... it lifted the ban, and then turns out that the attorney general, I believe, was able to reinstate it because the law previous to the, you know, what the situation was having the ban. So until they work it out in court, the ban got reinstated. So there was like a 2-hour window where you could legally buy magazines in Washington, just a little bit of breathing that we got.
Shit's also ridiculous.
It's absolutely crazy.
Do you ever? I'm starting to believe that politics is just reality TV for grownups, and so many of us were fooled or are still fooled into thinking that you're paying attention to real shit when the reality is it doesn't matter. It's a uniparty, and they're all in this shit together, and it's all meant. It's meant for exactly this, like to get us riled up and talking amongst each other about shit that doesn't even. We think we have an effect on it, but we don't. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, the changes are going to happen whether we want them to or not, no matter how... They're playing by a different set of rules than we are. And we're still here thinking that we can play by the rules and get ahead. And we don't realize that we're playing severely hamstrung and that the rules need to go out the fucking window.
But their rules are...
Their rules are much laxer than ours.
Yeah, but
and
also...
And they just sort of control everything.
That's where it becomes the difference. Their rules are like, this is for betterment, right? Which always gives self-entitlement.
No, I think it's, they tell you it's for betterment. It's, but, it's for yes. green energy or yeah. it's for it's public, the, it's for public
that's
safety.
That's what I mean. That's yeah. everything that's a negative has always been done in the eyes of betterment.
Yeah.
What they say is betterment.
But my that's point, my you, point is that they get people, they have people fighting with each other.
Yeah.
And thinking that the problem is one side or the other, when the reality is there is no one side or the other. It's their team versus the peasants.
Yeah.
Well, that's the two sides.
They have influence. They have money. They have the ability yeah, to.
I know, Mike.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're getting at.
But it's like they act like they put it on. You say like they act like they put it on, like everything in politics seems like a ruse.
It's
like,
a reality show. It's to keep us arguing about things that we think we have control of.
Yeah.
But the reality is you don't have control of it. Your vote doesn't actually count because they both work for the same people.
I feel yes and no. Because money is always the ultimate form of vote. You know, and so there's only a few people
at the top.
Yeah. Yeah, so there's a lot of monopoly happening.
Yes.
And so it all gets channeled
across the entire world.
Yes.
USA, but that's where taxes is the problem, right? And we've talked about it a couple times, having a flat fucking tax.
Couple times.
Having a flat tax and the issue becomes if you own anything, you still owe
property tax and stuff.
Yeah.
You never own anything, yeah.
And that ends up being the problem, right? Like, property tax, or you got to pay to drive the car you own.
Right. Well, so you're forever indebted. You're a debt slave that you just have to continue working until you can hope to get your Social Security. But even if you think you're getting ahead, like if you had asked me 3 years ago, I'd say, dude, I'm going to retire at 55 very comfortably. Then we hit this period of mass inflation, and now it's like maybe 65.
Yeah.
Just like that. Boom. So where did that value go? Because I put all my value in. Why did my value suddenly decrease? And it's because they spread it out over, you know, more paper dollars, or not even paper dollars, just fake zeros and ones in their computer system.
Yeah.
So I still put in all that energy. Now the energy return that I basically signed a contract to get back, it's not going to be given to me.
And that leads us into the apocalypse.
Mm-hmm.
So, we're back, boys.
Gold and silver.
The taxes fucked us. Taxes fucked us. The gun law ban fucked us. Everything fucked us. These are hard times. We have to become hard men. R.I.P. Peleliu. Yeah. Never forget, dude. That's a true never forget.
Yeah.
Okay, so I started numbering these. Okay, so it's been the most dire of times. The infestation of ruthless, homeless hordes, marauders, degenerates like myself. Mike Zedong rallied his team and we're taking over. And it just becomes a little too hot.
They're all dressed in fucking linen.
No, dude, we're going to have that zip-up suit, like the oil mechanic, you know, like communist. Oh,
the blue. Yeah,
yeah.
The blue workers uniform.
Yeah. Dude, I'll rule your people, and I'll change your oil. Dude, I'm going to look like I work at Jiffy Lube. It's going to be awesome.
But, DuPont fucking suit.
Yeah, dude, a pit team? Are you kidding me? That'd be awesome. Fuck yeah, dude. Okay, so we got to get out of here. What is the best vehicle to make a 500-plus mile journey? Post-apocalypse when, I'm going to say it, post-apocalypse when maybe that it's an EMP, and so a lot of cars are not working anymore, like modern-day cars.
Going horse or dirt bike?
I'd say dirt bike. That's probably the number one. If you can fit what you need on it.
I got one better. Are you kidding me?
A quad?
No.
Quad would be better.
I am going to the firefighter museum. I am going to go get an old, like, 1960s engine that's all pristine and that the fire department kept going. And I'm going to steal a fire engine and I'm going to drive it 500 miles on a ladder truck, dude.
There you go.
That might be hard to weave in and out.
That's going to be tough to get through the gridlock.
But I have the power to just plow through.
You think you have the power to plow through, huh?
Yeah. On a heavy rig like that? Hey, what, man, if I welded? Like
miles of cars on I-5.
Yeah. What if I welded like a cattle, like, you know?
You're like the icebreaker for the post-apocalyptic traffic debacle. Yeah,
that's how you get through?
A cattle.
Well, it's either that or a bus. Guard. A bus? Like bus. A huge Greyhound bus.
Now that Jordan said quad, I think a quad with a little trailer.
Yeah. Fuck that, dude. A cattle guard and a fire engine.
And I got the one. Look, this, I hate to tell you, but.
Don't you need a rear driver in the ladder truck?
All right, I won't do it. I'll do an engine.
You gotta have a team.
I'll just do an engine. A nice, strong.
They're gonna, like, are these, is this some volunteer firefighters in a pit crew uniform?
What, dude, I look,
I'm
like
telling you, I do want a Mad Max vehicle. So maybe you can build your Mad Max vehicle on the ladder truck platform. Yeah, that could be.
Yeah,
I'm
be
going. Pretty cool. I'm going to,
because your guitar player could be up on the ladder. You could extend the ladder and like you could be up there wailing.
Oh, Jesus.
Dude, some survivors just see a guy going down the freeway, plowing cars, playing guitar in the back of a ladder. Yeah. Are you kidding me? Mike Zadong will rise again. Never forget that.
I also like that our apocalypse plans include us having a guitar player.
Yeah, you have to. My name is Sebastian.
We're going to have fucking solar panels just for the amps.
Dude, the truck dies every 50 miles when I'm really riffing.
Damn it.
Fuck.
Who killed the batteries? I hit a sweet solo, bro. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Goddamn whammy bar got in the way. Sorry, Toledo. We're not making it. Now, I think you want something. If you're really going to go and the roads are clogged, you need something that's going to push out. Like a massive tow truck that's like that has that flatbed on the back. Yeah, if you had like a cattle guard, dude, you could just plow through traffic. You're like an icebreaker.
But I think you'd burn through all your fuel real fast and then you'd be stuck.
I mean, I like the thought of it, but I think the way to go wouldn't, again, because if you're... You know how many people are going to be on those fucking roads?
Don't matter. I'm the snowplow. Call Mr. Plow. That's my name.
Oh, my God.
I think you're going to want to be dirt bikes off-road.
As we reestablish a society, there's a single TV channel, and you got Mike coming on there. Hey, guys, if anybody needs your driveway or your mom plowed this winter, give me a call.
Do a 2-for-1 special.
Yeah. Tis the season.
Mr. Plow.
Oh, my God.
Driveways and moms half off.
I think. So stupid, dude. Oh, that's hilarious. I think roads, like, I hear where you're coming from. Like, it's the same way I feel like the bolt action gun. Yeah. Like, roads are going to be fucked. So, you know, like, a four-wheeler, a horse, a dirt bike, a bicycle can weave. It can get you through things. But if you're trying to have people or go a great distance, you're going to need a lot of fuel and a platform that can kind of handle anything. You get a bridge that's out, it's like, good luck jumping that fire truck.
You can actually, like, with a half-assed decent bike, you can get pretty mobile. It's which true. Is also pretty awesome.
You just load up and have like an apocalypse motor. Ooh, would you have a sidecar? Like you could put your shit in.
I'm talking like a pedal bike.
Oh. Was this China?
I'd rather die.
Dude, who's wearing that oil mechanic suit now, dude? Riding a bicycle? Dude, nailed it.
Fucking,
oh, my God.
Maybe an apocalypse in Vietnam. Yeah. Fucking guy.
Hang on. We pedaled fucking mountain bikes in to go bear hunting last year.
Yeah, and if I could have rode a motorcycle, I would
have. Right,
if I could have driven a fire truck, I would have. Dude, there's no bears here. It's weird. Onk, onk. Hit the lights.
We went in lights and sirens.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I think... I just think you don't want to go big and loud. I think you want to go quick, agile and small. Yeah. And slip I think through. That, like, I mean, ideally, if, like...
What's that motorcycle you have?
The TW200.
Real panty dropper.
Yeah, yeah. Keeps them wet. Keeps them wet. the old T-dub, dude. Yeah.
It's like in the apocalypse. Like, it's the same way a Ferrari pulls up now and a girl's like, oh, hey, what do you do?
How much money would it take you to get... How much money would it take? How much money do I have to raise on Patreon to get you to ride your motorcycle through Lake Stevens shirtless this summer?
Oh, dude.
Shirtless?
Are you kidding me?
$25?
Are you kidding me? Well, it depends on how much you want to raise with the video. Because, you know, I think they're out there. I'm probably like the fucking screensaver to some chick's fucking background right now from last summer. Yeah, I'll tell you.
It's more likely how much money you're going to raise to stop him of riding with his shirt off. You did it last year. Yeah, that sounds about right.
Ripping around the lake, dude.
Yeah.
Oh, picking up a six-pack. Oh, yeah.
Following a school bus, dropping kids off. Yeah, yeah. Who's that guy?
These high school girls. Oh, shit. The same age.
Oh, shit. Is that a TW?
Oh, damn.
It's nice. Yeah.
Nice.
Hat on back. God. Nice. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. Golly.
So you guys are biker boys. The apocalypse happens. You guys are bicycle and biker boy.
I think
a dirt bike's a great option.
I think you want to be able to zip.
I bought that XR250 you're on a bike. For a reason.
Good luck. You're on a bike, dude. Yeah. You've established it. Jordan.
I think you want to be able to like weave in and out of
traffic.
Traffic. The thing is you're giving up a lot in the storage department.
Storage and also safety. Say you run into shit, that fire truck is cover.
Yeah, well, so
you get ambush.
Car around
it's also much easier to ambush a fire truck than a dirt bike because the dirt bike can kind of squirt through. Yeah. The fire truck's going to be slow and cumbersome.
True. And
makes a very easy target.
It's a classic metal.
A single rider on a dirt bike is a difficult target.
Yeah. It's your classic twisted metal issue.
Yeah, that's,
you know.
I got an ice cream truck.
Yeah, you got an ice cream truck. Some guys got
golf car.
Yeah, exactly. So, I think the motorcycle's the way to go.
You can't put your guitar player on a dirt bike.
Yeah, well, you can. Yeah, that's true.
I've been to Pakistan.
Yeah. Yeah. We wear sweater vests.
I've been to Pakistan. We put a family of six on a 125cc dirt bike. Actually.
You gear it right?
But you gear it right.
Shit. It's right. You get the low gearing, you can actually put your goats on there too.
Yeah.
Hit that power band.
Take them off, dude. I don't know. I like to think like if you just could have any vehicle, I think just a truck, right? Like, and if you could get around stuff and go up and over because
like a real you're not taking a fucking truck.
You're not taking
If you could get one here, a Hilux would be phenomenal.
Like a lifted something like with the wind.
I'd go bone stock. Those things are so bulletproof as they are.
I think a something bone stock that you Hilux. Could take into mountain roads is what you want. A four wheel drive mountain road.
Do you think winches are important? Then?
Like a maybe. I mean, yeah. I don't know.
Would you be lifted in big tires?
No, I wouldn't get some crazy bullshit.
Would you be lowered?
Possibly.
I think those high performance type off road shit. I think the high performance off road stuff is high maintenance. There's the Hilux is third world tested.
Yeah, it's like the fucking just, AK
You're not trying to set speed records. You're just trying to move.
Yeah, but
point
I'm
A to
also
point B.
thinking mountain passes. Like when you're
Hilux.
You're going over a pass.
There's
that
no
roads aren't.
It's the only truck that goes over the Hindu Kush, other than those giant fucking. That's the other thing. Those giant fucking Jenga like.
He's like those fire ton, trucks,
like a fire truck body.
No, not like an American fire truck.
Yeah, European,
it's
Asian
a,
fire truck.
It's each one of those Jenga trucks is a fucking ecological disaster in itself. And they can chug over the Hindu Kush, and Hiluxes go over. And I don't think too many other vehicles go over.
Mopeds.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know if you've seen a Jeep Liberty Compass lately.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, so
are you kidding me?
Best apocalypse, like automobile, Hilux without question.
Yeah, I think that would be the like a small diesel fucking.
But then aren't you guys just instantly getting stuck on that grid? On that track, you try and go, like, how are you going to go from here to those mountain
roads? That's what I'm saying. I don't think you're going. I don't think an automobile is a good apocalypse option because you're not going to get onto the main roads.
Well, we got to go 500 miles.
We're riding a motorcycle.
Dirt bike.
Yeah.
And you're packing gas on it.
Yeah, you're going
to
have
to. Or just raiding cars.
Yeah, but
you're going to have to have siphon kits and maybe like a jerry can that you can bolt on.
So that's another little.
Too bad I have like a, what is it?
And that's why you
need a 3,000 gallon tank.
You're going to need a four stroke.
On my fire truck. Maybe I put some gas in it I raid from Chevron.
I don't think you get that thing through the roads.
Mike.
You know, when you got a cattle guard on and a positive attitude, you can get a lot accomplished in the apocalypse. You guys are fucking.
So here's the deal is no, Mike is being very headstrong, which is how he would be in the apocalypse.
Kozak.
So
never.
So because, you know, maybe his tenacity to push truck out of way like cattle.
Push truck out. You sound like Frankenstein. Push truck out of way. Yeah, dude.
I just, it's
going to be tough to
I'd love to see it.
Yeah, I would too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe even a UPS. I feel like a UPS isn't
no
heavy
fucking
enough.
Way.
You need something with
they
a bit
ain't got
more
enough balls.
Bones.
Yeah.
Bones, yeah.
I guess the only other vehicle I would think would be a good apocalypse option is one of those like Sprinter type built out campers.
Yeah.
Or in any sort of small camper, just because it offers you a little bit of mobile shelter.
Yeah, but there's no. It's shelter from the elements, but not from.
But it has some comfort. Like you have a bed, you have a. Yeah, you have a shower, you have cooking. You have a cooktop and a refrigerator.
I think it's going to be a high target. I think a lot of people are going to.
Dude, van
go
life is going to take van off. Life, van life. Yeah. Like, hey, there's a Roman horde, yeah. But I caught a fucking rainbow trout on this lake. Yeah.
Be the new.
Oh, man.
My dad met a chick doing van life.
What was the tribe that chased the herd? Sorry.
Shut up, Jordan.
My bad. I was trying to finish my thought. Go ahead.
I was just trying to keep sounds coming out of these things. Nah. My dad said he met. This story's going nowhere now. Anyway, what were you saying?
I was just saying the new nomadic tribes would be van life people.
Oh, 100%.
Chasing buffalo herds across the plains and they're fucking
chasing gasoline,
their diesel Sprinter Mercedes,
chasing
whatever.
Granola from Arco to
yeah, you're
Arco,
right, you're right.
Looking for
chasing gluten free tacos.
Have you guys seen Wi-Fi? I haven't seen it in 2 months.
Where do the gluten free tacos live? We're gonna try to hunt some down.
That's van life. Then, dude, you would just stumble on like a van. You'd open it up. And it'd be like some hippie chick with long hair and her skeleton and just crystals all over the van.
Just everywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
A fucking little stick of kale in her.
Yeah. In all her dried hand. Up like her. Just mummified kale and body. Yeah. Van life. Van life. Apocalypse van life. Shit. Okay, so I think you guys are all dying. No, I'll clear the way and you can follow me. It's cool. Right. So we're out of here in the apocalypse. I'm in my fire truck. I'm plowing the way for you boys. I'm also a refueling station. Yeah. You're welcome. Ammo reservoir, also protection. So probably got some food and a little bit of shelter on there. So we're covering a lot of bases.
Things going for me.
Yeah. And the guitar, music, covered. Dinner and a show. So we're out of there. If you could choose five people or like five different types of people, skill sets. We're doing, look at that skill. That's teamwork. That's survival. That's apocalypse right there.
That's a diverse tool right there.
Look at that. Yeah. Sorry.
If you could choose five people in apocalypse to survive with, who would they be? Right? Okay. And also, as a little.
Including yourself?
Oh, would you include yourself and why?
You have to.
Well, if
do you think you add to the team? Yes. Do you think you don't?
Yes. Okay.
Especially because I've had four other people are going to be hot chicks.
Also, the ads were.
Remember so, those yeah. Coors Light twins?
I'm going to be the strongest, the fastest, probably the smartest. Oh, shit. If I'm lucky. Sorry, go ahead.
What?
Oh, I thought you were going to go.
Oh,
who are five? What are five? So for me, it would be like, okay, you want security. So it's like you want someone that has shooting, security, maybe a little demolitions knowledge to their skills. It would be nice to have someone with medical, so maybe more skilled than a nurse, maybe a trauma type doctor, or even just a general PT, because knowing infectious type diseases, you would want someone that's good at growing slash cooking, so like a farmer type skill set, right? I also think you're kind of going to want a manager in a way, because there's a lot going on. You want someone to just make sure the community's being cohesive. Someone saying, hey, is it tough on the bakers? Can we scare up, or can we spare a person to help out this group? What's going on? There has to be a little bit of an oversight. So you're going to need someone to kind of lead the group in a little bit of a way. The group does need a leader. Right. And they're not necessarily the strongest at any one of those things, but maybe they dabble in it or have a better picture of what's going on. Was that four or was that five?
I don't know.
That's a fifth one.
You said,
but what I keep thinking, because I was sitting here trying to list, you were listing all these skills off, and I was kind of like, oh, fuck. Yeah, there's that and that and that and that. And I've been having a lot of those thoughts lately, too, because I have one customer who is crafty. Like, she sews and she quilts. And she has chicken. You know what I mean? It's like, that's really important too, to have someone who can make, like, nobody thinks about how long does a pair of jeans last you. So if the textile mills and the Levi's plant in Taiwan doesn't reestablish trade across the Pacific Ocean, where are you going to get pants in 3 years?
Yeah, you're going to, just the way so there's guns. We
need
everywhere.
People who know how to do things.
There,
and you need carpenters, and you need, so it's like everybody needs to be multifaceted. And so, not to sound like I'm tooting my own horn, but I have good leadership skills. That's valuable. I understand the tactical, safety, security kind of situational type stuff. That's valuable. And I'm a really good handyman slash builder slash mechanic. Things,
God damn, this isn't an interview, dude. Yeah.
Dude, you got serious.
But all three of those things are important if you had to start a society. And you have to start looking, because everybody wants to, when we talk apocalypse, it's like guns and ammo, guys who know how to fight, do you have a plate carrier? What about all the other shit? Because in order to put a single troop in the field, you need like five people behind him, providing him food, providing him, like, where do his pants come from?
Yeah.
Where does his equipment come from? Who man? You know what I mean? There's all this other ancillary stuff that has to happen before you can even think about fighting. Yeah. But everybody immediately wants to think about fighting.
Because I think people get scared, though, and people fight. I think just conflict is, though, will go through the roof.
When you look at where you fought in a country of, what's it? Materialistic things weren't, there wasn't abundance.
Right. Or hang on.
Here,
there's tons of shit.
There's tons of shit. So that, I think, and for what you'd be fighting for would be a little different in the sense of, like, picking up things. I don't know that, I mean, certainly sewing and all that, but, like, if you don't think that, like, every house you went into wouldn't have fucking 10 jackets.
Oh, yeah, I get that part.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So, like, there's that. I think there is something super valuable in having the wherewithal and the knowledge of being able to, if you're building the society, if you've gotten to that point and, like, you know, there's not stuff to just pick up. And because, I mean, you're going to be able to pick up fucking clothes forever in America. There's just so much. There's so much. There's so many fucking pairs of pants.
What does that buy you, though? Like a generation?
Fuck no.
But I mean, what's the future of the country, though? If you're
oh certainly yes. So if you're at that point, yes. So there,
I get that for like 3 to 5 years. Yeah, for a first,
I think you're looking for the rest of our lives and our children's lives.
There's enough shit just laying around Walmart warehouses and clothes. Yeah, you're probably right.
Clothes would change. Like furs and leathers would become more fashionable. Textiles, well, like I think just having canvases would be would rare start being after like 100 right? years. Like, if it was, just,
I mean, think if you couldn't even get textiles. Think if you couldn't get what a I roll mean. Of denim or a roll of cotton or a roll of whatever.
Yeah, alligator pants. Of course,
but we live in America, which is the most materialistic country I would imagine, abundant, right? Yeah. I would imagine that there is a pair of pants for everybody in Washington.
And what if everybody in Washington is 50 pounds overweight and you're
going to learn to sew?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
There's going to be plenty of fucking denim. On those fucking
yeah. So would you
hang on. You know what I mean?
It's got to cut a little like out.
A couple mistakes,
you're gonna,
I'll be
you're
okay.
You're going to have to take a lot of clothes
down
in.
To a 32 here.
Yeah, you're going to have to take a lot of clothes in, but there's going to be ways in which to make that. So I don't know that you would have to necessarily learn that right away, but I think that you would have people that could back engineer when you start looking at it and you go, okay.
But it's not even here. It's in other countries.
Would a tailor yeah, but be you important can, you can on build your
looms. Right, you can build looms out of fucking.
You'd have to.
I don't want to get too deep into like the reinventing society.
Well, I mean,
because that's like a whole other topic, like the rebuilding.
Have you looked into like how to? This, I'm fucking sound like an build idiot right now. No, yes, like so.
Yeah, Jordan has extensively.
Tell
researched.
Me what you know
I,
about. Loom
I have,
making.
I have, and yeah. Like sheep and wool, and taking the wool and fucking combing it out, and then you have there's these big brushes. And
you know what I love nails. Is that you're not joking. He has.
We have a spinning wheel.
You can do it with,
the
you can
claws.
Do it with these. Yeah, and then you take that and it fucking goes, and you can take it and you strand basically pat it. And it strands out, right? And then there's like these spinning wheels, right? With the thing,
one.
And you can, he's got one.
Turn it into yarn.
So
then you can
turn
knit.
It. Yep. You turn it into yarn, then you're making fucking beanies. You're making beanies.
And hacky sacks.
And hacky sacks. Dude, you're going to be able to smoke so much weed.
Yeah,
and be so
dude, we're
warm.
Making hacky sacks.
Dude. That and some fucking, yeah.
That's
some,
what the first communities were founded around.
Dude, yeah. What if we made a really good hacky sack?
That would actually be pretty sweet.
Yeah,
far
right?
Out, bro.
Far, yeah. I do like hacky sack.
And that's really what we're going for, you know?
That's what I'm going to use that wool for.
Well, so
yeah,
there's tons of different, like.
So would you say a tailor's important?
Well, and this
then
is another thing. Like,
the
there's these little looms, right? These little looms. So if you get a rip in your pants, right? These little fucking things you take and you put on your pants and it creates like a patch mm-hmm. And you can patch your clothes. I sound like an idiot, but you can essentially like there's little kits that you can get that will fix rips and clothes and shit for like you went, God, what, where the fuck are we going? Did I smoke the weed or did you guys?
I'm going to say anyway. One of your five people is going to be a tailor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Jordan, dude, gonna you're going to look proper during the apocalypse. You're going to have custom, like, jeans and
no, it's gonna
jackets.
Be great. It's going to be great.
You're going to look like John Wick the whole time.
We hope. I'm kind of hoping to get more like Davy Crockett. Like with the coonskin cap coons, and the
yeah.
Yeah, the deer skin.
He's going Daniel Boone.
Deer skin pants and jacket.
All right, so you guys,
pelts,
it's five people.
Mini pelts.
Five people. Mm-hmm. What would you want people-wise? Five people.
So
okay, you need one. Go ahead. You go.
The Mighty Ducks cast.
Yeah.
All their attributes.
Yes.
We're going to need a fat guy who can cook good. Mm-hmm. We're going to need a leader.
Well,
we're
going to
need some guys who can score points, which means they can fight and you know, fuck.
Yeah.
we're going to need a couple.
Our women.
Women, right? Possibly goalies because we keep them back at the house. We keep them safe. They're not out and skating around the rink. Yeah, things like that.
Okay. What about a mechanic? Do you think someone that's very mechanically inclined?
Yes.
Someone that could work on a dozer, an old 60s car, anything, an old generator?
Or a horse-drawn plow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is it? Well, I guess that's mechanical.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Being, I would rather have a horse guy and just figure it out with the plow than have a plow expert and no horse guy.
Yeah,
you're right.
You know? I think having mechanic would be,
I'm that'd
be clutch. Key. Having somebody who knows how to fucking sail.
That'd be good.
Yeah.
Having somebody who can work boats.
That's a huge,
but it depends where we
rope
going.
Knowledge.
We going to Montana and I got a sailor. It's like, psh, but we're on the coast of California, and it's like, I need this guy.
Sorry, buddy.
Yeah, you did what? You're a longshoreman? Yeah, we're in fucking
hey, check out what's
Missoula.
In that bag. Cool. Yeah.
Dig this hole for us, dude.
Yeah. No, I think, but it just depends where you are and what your situation is. If you're on the coast, maybe if the shit does hit the fan, stealing a nice boat and skedaddling. Yeah. Dude, food's unlimited. Yeah. If they have those things for condensation, for... Are they called desalination? Or are they just normal? Let's call
it desalination. I think everybody knows what we're talking about.
They have condensation bags also that capture the sea mist, and it dries... What? The sea mist?
Oh, oh yeah, right. I thought he was the going somewhere mist. Else. I was like, oh, Lee.
Okay. How do you survive for 42 Protein. Days?
He came back stronger.
Yeah.
What the fuck?
But stealing a boat wouldn't be bad if you lived in L.A. and it started to burn down and you went to the Bay Area and stole a boat. Kidding me?
That's kind of my get home. I think we've talked about that as well. My get home strategy for
stealing a boat to Lake Stevens.
To get to Lake Stevens. You such an idiot, dude.
Sorry, I'm throttling you, dude. Tell me about your gear on the boat to Lake Stevens.
Well, it's going to have wheels. And.
Nailed it, dude.
Yeah, I'm going to steal one of those ducks.
Okay.
Ooh, that would be a good apocalypse vehicle. You'd have a lot more fun.
Yeah. I mean, see, now we're talking.
Duck land boat. Or
you,
sea.
You put a cattle prod on a duck. Let me
think about this. A duck boat? That would be fucking badass.
Yeah.
You know, those are all military vehicles.
Yeah. Dude, also, it's like the bridge is out. I can't take my fire truck over it. Let's cross this river with my duck.
Yeah, there you go.
Yawn out of that one. So, next question. The five people didn't hit strong, but... okay, so speaking of teaming up, would you team up with an animal, and what would it be?
Are we talking like Clyde and any which way but loose? Like
my guy.
Yeah, like a monkey?
Like I kind of orangutan, yeah. Just like hanging, like he's riding shotgun.
Dude.
Sometimes he drives.
You dude. Have an apocalypse the animal. Bump? What is it?
If
I got orangutan.
No, my guy is going bird.
Oh, one of you guys is Birdlaw. You're going to be a falconer?
Birdlaw, dude.
I'm going to have a fucking falcon who can tell me when danger's coming. And he's going to fucking sail over and like look.
So you're like Beastmaster.
Are you going to become Arabian as soon as this bird appears?
Yeah, I'm
fucking... A BB.
Yeah. It's going to be great. Yeah, I'm taking a bird. I'm teaching him how to bring me shit, shiny stuff. Come on, bud.
He can only spot, though. He's hard at doing. Like you can't make a lot of things happen.
Have you ever seen a crow?
Sweet, he can gather nuts and intel. You know what I mean?
What more do you need?
Action sometimes.
Dude, have you ever seen they're called the murder a crow for a reason.
Say I need to get into a locked room. How's this crow going to do it?
Fly into the window, dude.
Until he breaks it.
Do what you gotta do.
Dude, then your animal's gone. He was my spirit animal.
Sacrificed the body.
He was essential for one mission, and it was so important. He pulled it off.
Yeah, dude, that's what every good movie
turns
has.
Out there was nothing in there.
Dude, that would be awesome
every,
in a movie.
Every good movie.
Dude, someone's like, how are we going to get through this window? He's like, I got a bird. It just dies smashing through a window. And he's like, that was it. Good job.
Goes, what about this brick?
Dude, I think the best animal is you have a cerebral connection, like Avatar, with a raccoon.
Oh, my God.
Fuck. I mean, dude, they have
he's
thumbs like...
dexterous fingers. As soon as it came to that shit, when he's like, what would they do?
They wash their food.
Yeah. You're dexterous.
They're just like us. They're small. An orangutan, I like it, but he's too fucking big, and he's always patting his belly.
Mike,
you know
but yeah,
I mean?
But this is... My apocalypse movie is like a buddy cop comedy.
Yeah, you know what I mean? What
so
the
like,
fuck?
See, it's more like we're hanging out, he meets a girl orangutan... There's hijinks, right? and then the apocalypse is over.
But you need something
and
to
then
drive
we
around
sail
with.
Off into the sunset.
Yeah.
Yeah, but you can't ride a motorcycle with an orangutan and have
the
hijinks.
Fuck, are you fucking kidding
you
me?
You need a fire truck with a cattle prod.
How can
so
you not
can
have
sit.
Hijinks if you're no, riding a motorcycle
dude,
with, an orangutan,
ladder,
with
see,
an orangutan?
That's why I have a bird, because I'm riding my motorcycle and he's flying.
And if I had an orangutan, then he could hang on to the motorcycle with his feet, and he could be my guitar player.
Yeah, sidecar.
Right?
Sorry, my raccoon pulled the pins out of the wheels on your motorcycle with his bullshit. Dexterous little hands.
No, he didn't.
He's an inside
no,
informant.
He didn't. No, my
dude,
fucking
raccoon,
hawk would have told me.
Dude, he can
my
sneak.
Hawk would have fucking tossed him off a cliff like a goat. Mm.
That's true.
You ever see the movie? What's the one?
Burrowing along
with Cliffhanger.
Yeah, that's a good movie. Yeah. And John Lithgow.
Is that in the very beginning? Or I'm sorry, I'm getting
not
that
Cliffhanger. The I'm one getting, with
yeah, confused
is
with
it, is that Hot Shots or
no the Pet Cemetery?
Oh, Pet Detective.
Pet Cemetery. That's right. No. Have
Ace Ventura,
Pet Detective.
Yeah, what about it?
The cliffhanger, the kind raccoon of spoof. Falls.
No, and he catches. Oh. Yeah,
little dexterous fucking hands didn't help him then, did it? No.
This is good pod, gentlemen.
sorry, guys. Back to the apocalypse.
I think a raccoon is a great animal. He can bite fuel lines. He can need to get into a house. He'll go underneath into the subflooring or up into the attic.
Using it as an assassination tool.
No, get me into this house. It's locked. He can help. He's in tune with the animal world. So maybe he can tell me of snakes or danger like that. But I think he'd be a great dude. He can steal stuff.
Snakes are danger. That's a t-shirt. Snakes are danger.
Look,
I'm gonna be in the Everglades.
Cruising altitude.
A raccoon is freaking. I think it's the ultimate apocalypse animal. Okay. I used to think it was a cougar.
A cougar.
Hang on. The other thing I like about this conversation is that I think you have thought about this.
Why do you think I have pages?
I don't think you thought about this for 10 minutes. I think you've been thinking about how good of a apocalypse animal a raccoon is for a long time.
Getting high off of paint. Just fucking
a raccoon.
I think there's something to this.
How long ago did you first have this thought?
About 6 months ago, I really started playing around with this raccoon idea.
I guess you're kicking it around.
Because everyone would think it's also like, oh, it's just nature's fucking taking back over.
No one else would think about a raccoon as an apocalypse.
Yeah, they go, this little dirt panda.
Yeah, exactly.
This little trash panda, look at it.
Nature's taken back over. Why would I suspect anything? Meanwhile, my little homie's doing reconnaissance, going through your attic, telling me what's in your house. Fuck. Maybe he'll steal something you have that I need. He'll grab me your keys so I don't have to break in.
Chances are my fucking hawk would see that shit with his hawkeye. Yeah. And he'd he'd fly down and snatch with his fucking talons that can grab keys. He'd snatch that up. Maybe grab your fucking, maybe he'd grab your raccoon by the neck, the scruff of his fucking neck. Take him to 800 foot elevation, maybe. Oh, shit. This is getting and just personal. Say, hey, that's don't my, ever do it again. Oh, that's should my I drop dodge it? And rim. Maybe he starts dropping him.
No.
Lets him fall.
Lets him hang by one claw.
You know what? But those dexterous hands, he can guide his float. And he's got all that weird arm belly skin.
Yeah.
Soft landing in the trees.
Oh, is that what you think?
Then, yeah.
No, because my guy is up there tossing him around, playing. Awesome.
Was this prison?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He'd be tossing him, all right. Yeah, yeah. Sky prison.
Oh, my God.
To which
Mr.
Your,
Mittens, no.
Yeah. No. To which your little coon.
Squeeze your butthole, buddy. Squeeze that bum bum.
Yeah. Not going to happen. You ain't like your dad. Anyway.
Well, I think that's all the animal debate.
Yep.
Raccoon's the best.
Maybe a simple dog.
That's actually really good. I think the raccoon has something to it. Okay.
We'll leave that for later.
We're flipping. Yeah.
Agree
undecided.
To agree.
Agree
to
undecided. Agree. Undecided. Yeah. This is called undecided. Yeah. Okay. So we've lived through all of this apocalypse. It's been a harrowing time on this 1 year journey / anniversary. So say the blackout happened, the shit happened, but now it seems to have changed a little bit. If a foreign country invaded, would that change your plan compared to a grid down situation? Yes. Not only your motivations, 100%. But your actions and what.
I'm going to pee. I don't know if you guys want to pause it or just talk.
Okay. Oh, we hit the. Dude, the lion's getting a kick.
Mike, did I hear you say you were going to name your raccoon Cerberus?
I would like to. So, what I thought would be an awesome, like, if I could have an oil painting. Would be me driving an apocalypse fire truck with Cerberus sitting shotgun
playing guitar.
maybe driving the ladder truck the back.
A raccoon could play a guitar, too, by the way, because they have dexterous fingers.
Fingers are so mobile.
Maybe a ukulele.
Oh, they can. They can play a cello. They can play a flute.
Yeah.
What else?
Hell of a fiddle.
Yeah. Oh, my God. You haven't lived till you've seen a raccoon play a fiddle. Cerberus. Hit it. Okay, so I've never seen a person jump more alive other than Tobin getting ready to read ads when I said, if a foreign country invaded, would that change your plan compared to a grid down situation? 100%. You're going...
I'm going offensive.
You're going Braveheart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And guerrilla style. Yeah. So, and hidden. What's fun about this is it's so easy to do... Yeah. You just start doing.
Would
hit
you
and run.
Be
you
militia,
hit and run.
Or would you join up with the resistance?
Resistance.
Yeah.
And singleton type ambushes can instill so much chaos that the invading force then has to increase their security posture, and you just start draining them dry. So just like we said, I don't know, 20 minutes ago, that every troop in the field requires 5 to 8 behind them doing support operations. If you make it to where the security situation is such that a single, like say you've got Chinese soldiers and they're spread out kind of like, you know, like police officer precincts almost, where one soldier has 8 square
Chinese
blocks or
police.
Whatever. Yeah, that would never happen in North America, right?
Uh-uh.
Huh. Wait, don't they already have Chinese police stations in? Yeah. Well, so... You make it to where a single patrolman cannot patrol by himself. He needs a security team around him because you're actively hunting them.
But you're like slow bleeding them because it takes so many to
You ambush
make one work.
You ambush when you have a target of opportunity, and when you don't, you don't. You choose.
But that's
kind of
like
the moment to fight.
You mean it like more in a guerrilla warfare style? Like if you look at like the German in the U.S. of World War II, a lot of it was like getting behind enemy and cutting off supply routes because maybe they have enough to get them through
you bleed
for
them
2 weeks,
right?
But in another month, they're going to be fucking hurting. And that's
but
when
not only
really
that,
live.
But now they have to dedicate more resources to putting more people to
just
pull security
to
for the supply route. They have to start securing the supply route. So that requires more people. That requires more resources. So you start creating these little situations where the security is punctured. You puncture their security bubble, and then they have to put more resources at that puncture. And those resources bleed value, right? Bleed the system. Look at what the Taliban did to the Russians in the 80s and to us in, 2001 to, a couple of years ago, right? They just bled us of resources because they didn't necessarily have to fight. They could look and see a company of infantry marines walking up a valley and be like, not going to fight today.
Do you think
because they don't have to, they live there. They don't have to fight. They have the game plan is much longer when you live there.
Do you think that if bleeding is the biggest strategy, which I agree in war, do you think a lot of a U.S. invasion would technically be fought in the mountains to choke supply points? Because everything, unless you go around through the Panama Canal, the most direct is just east to west, but you have two giant mountain ranges separating the United States.
Yeah, you have
Do you
two
feel
major lines
those
of defense.
Would be where a lot of resources would be to funnel either steel resources, supplies,
think about
or
Washington
stop.
State. If they wanted to use Port of Seattle to bring in weapons and material type stuff, you have the North Cascades Pass, which is unpassable half the year. You have Stevens Pass, Snoqualmie Pass, and then White Pass. You have three opportunities, and then you get to the gorge. So call it 4 opportunities to cross the mountains in Washington State. So that's pretty easy to concentrate, fighting forces on. If you're the guerrillas, trying to prevent them from spreading east,
we'll blow the river or the
and there's so many
over.
Overpasses, and it would be so it easy to slow. Damage it, and you could choke them out right here on the coast.
Well, look at what happened just with that. Ship that hit that bridge in Boston, and Baltimore. They're lucky because it's only 4% commercial port, like up north a little bit towards New York. It more is used for import export.
Do you think that was a message?
Yeah, or they didn't know.
I don't know. They say it's fuel, is what I hear. word on the street is fuel.
Sure, it sure hit that pylon but, dead center.
Yeah, it's like you would never
you
know.
Don't know. If they Does it luck or... Or did someone take control? All of our electronics are made somewhere else.
So you guys, so I always think of these apocalypse like I'm just a single me. Like if in
with
my...
A, with a raccoon.
Yeah. Yeah, Artemis or whatever his name is.
Cerberus.
Cerberus. But
I'll name my orangutan Artemis.
Artemis and Cerberus, dude. I like him. That's a good buddy cup. But... If the apocalypse happens and then war happens, how does that change your plan? Are you instantly like, I'm running to the front lines to joining the resistance? Like, what about family? What about group?
No, you, it's like, how do immediate you survive plan is you have to that? You have to sort of secure your people.
Yeah.
Right? And then you're going to have to figure out a plan. Who's going to go do what? Right? Who's going to join the resistance? Who's going to go fight on the front lines? Is it even worth fighting on the front lines, or is it better to fight from within, behind the lines?
Yeah. Well, that makes me... go ahead, sorry.
Something I thought about a lot is, as we get later into... Like, the future just brings technology, right? And are we going to be able to keep up?
That's so the drone sort of.
Yeah, we were talking the modern day Minuteman, and how much gear you need to be a modern day soldier is a lot.
Yeah,
and drones like drones we were just also talking,
change everything now. Yeah, the human soldier is when you can put a hand grenade on a $60 Amazon drone. The human soldier is obsolete.
Yeah,
yeah. So. When you start looking down that those kind of things, and which brings into another account is like, well, does that mean you need to have shotguns? You need to, if you're going to be your group, if you got a sniper and you got guys with
a saw gunner, you've got a sniper, you also need somebody with a shotgun. Maybe.
You got some skeet shooters in there to have to try and shoot these fucking drones down. You
need
right?
like an EMP gun.
Yeah. Well, and they have those, right? But I who knows? That's not
you can't buy that.
You can't go to
soon.
Fucking yeah. You ain't yeah. gonna get that at Big Five, right? Like it's
you can't
just,
get anything at Big Five,
right? Like that's just kind of the thing. You're not gonna be able to do certain things with the way technology is moving forward. So like when you start looking in these wars or fights, it's like. Do I have night vision? Do I have thermal? Do I have a drone? Do I have a fucking, you know, raccoon? You just don't. And that's, when it comes to that, it's like, I think sitting back, not trying to be, you can't fight that. You can't. Right? If you put a soldier's uniform on and you're putting a target on your back and you got to almost hope that like, hey, if I don't, have its uniform on. Hopefully they don't.
That's also why I say guerrilla warfare.
Yeah.
Because if you try to stand toe to toe with any sort of organized military that has those kinds of assets, it's you're right. You cannot, just like the Taliban could not beat us in a face to face fight, but they could just bleed us and bleed us and bleed us by picking and picking and picking, right? And never, it was a tactical mistake anytime they stood and fought. They should always have broken contact and just faded away.
Well, that's the thing about, I guess, if your country is invaded, home field advantage when it comes to the battlefield. I mean, you kind of look at Ukraine in the very beginning, and it's like, shit, man, the citizens did put up a fucking decent resistance, especially your normal, everyday person. But like to what you say, when... Very modern technologies, far superior technologies. It seems like we learned in a little bit in World War One, but two was truly air superiority wins. And when you have drones, it does really change the playing field of what happens if your country was to be invaded. But it makes me think it's like, so then what do? Do you just give up and die? Do you fight dying? Do you try and figure out a way to
No, you fight smarter. You fight not with a...
More people
profile, yeah, exactly. World, no,
exactly.
Like
we're burrowing.
Is it Sun Tzu that says move like a fish through water? So rather than putting on a plate carrier and a fucking helmet You dress like you would if you're going to the grocery store, and you watch for targets of opportunity, and you watch for patterns in the enemy's activity. And as if you can establish patterns, then you can really establish where the moment of opportunity is. Yeah. Then you do your one-man ambush, hit and run, and then you lay low, and then you're not on a timeline because you live there and you work there, and that's your home. So you're not going anywhere. So you have the rest of your life to bleed them dry. You're not the occupying force.
Also,
the occupying force is on a timeline. They are trying to achieve victory so that they can
go home.
Well, not you go know, home or tell job. Their people, hey, well, job well done. Our mean. Boys are coming. You know what I mean?
Accomplish a mission. Exactly. Go home.
They have a ticking clock.
They don't
want
to be
the there. Home force, the home field advantage is that you don't have a ticking clock. You live there, and you have all the time in the world to just bleed them dry.
Fucking herd of raccoons coming over that.
Fuck.
Jordan, you're going to say something, buddy.
No, I'm just taking that in. It's, yeah, there's definitely, like, you have to fight that kind of pokey kind of fight. You can't.
Death by 1,000 paper cuts.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Like Tobin says, that's Afghanistan. That's Iraq. That's blend in.
But when with technology being what it is and invading a country, do you think that there would be prisoners, or is it like we're coming for everybody? Because like in Afghanistan,
don't see
it was
the
like
Chinese invade. Like I cannot see a plan where that works.
I didn't say
the landmass is too large. So the people that are coming across the southern border, I think their job is to sow or discord.
Yeah,
and mayhem.
They will be.
Yeah, they will. And there will be Pants. Some sort of attacks. I think that will give. Oh man, here we go. Tinfoil hat time. We're gonna have some terrorist attacks that put us in a position where we need to, where we feel, not all of us, like we need to declare martial law. And that, you can see the push for authoritarianism that's been coming across Western nations the last couple of years. It's undeniable.
Yeah.
The censor, like, look at what's going on right now in Brazil today. Did you guys follow all that?
Uh-uh.
Where Elon Musk, there was some law passed in Brazil that said that Twitter can no longer, or Twitter has to censor whoever the Brazilian government said, and Elon Musk said, fuck it, I'm gonna give all these guys their accounts back and let them post anything they want on Twitter. And so there's a full-on civil conflict brewing in Brazil right now.
Huh.
And the situation here could turn that way very quickly. If a couple of attacks on U.S. soil, use that as an excuse to declare martial law, and then you have, just like, I don't think too many people know this, Ukraine, they didn't cancel their elections, quote unquote. They temporarily suspended their elections until the war is over. So Zelensky is in effect in power forever.
Czar.
Yeah, he's the new forever guy. So I could see the same thing happening here.
So, but if that kind of stuff happens,
forever might be a few weeks.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Who we got?
No, but then so
we got running a place. No,
hey, it's okay. Kamala's here.
Yeah, thank God,
our Lord and Savior. Yeah. So, but it makes me think if it did happen, like there was a blackout, say it was an EMP and it fried stuff. It's like they have all these drones and they focus a lot of it on like phone metadata, and like you see Ukraine stuff and they even bomb Russian people for posting on Telegram you know, there's a real way of following these things and correlating it to real world. If it was a situation where they did like an EMP and it's like we did kind of go back into the Stone Ages or infrastructure was gone, so there's no point to have a cell phone, it would be much harder. Yes, you have air superiority, but good job locating people not on cell phones, not having going through traffic lights and reading the data that comes in and says license plates.
Yeah, but
like
I mean,
you're very lethal. Yeah, but there's deer, there's animal. You'll see people and stuff, but it's going to be much harder to get that intel and that data to kill the snake head. Yeah, than it is in a world of technology. Maybe, like he says, our being the Afghani people digging in is our advantage. But if it is a real invasion, a lot of the communication, all that tech's gone. So it's like you do have a little bit more of a fighting chance.
So hang on, that's a good thing. If tech and communication goes down, because it forces you to be dissociated, which means if they round up one cell of resistance guys, there's no contact with the cell immediately adjacent to them.
Yeah,
they don't actually know each other. They just kind of have a common cause, and every once in a while they rub up against each other, but there's no formal communication or exchange of leadership.
Well, that's where you get a messenger raccoon.
Oh shit! All right, now we're talking.
A carrier pigeon.
Get that damn crow out of here, Jordan. Don't talk about Mr. Mittens.
Yeah,
like that.
They've won wars before. So, Sam, try and choose
technology. Okay, I feel like
orangutan could slip through centuries very easily.
Well, nobody's trying to.
Look at him. He's so cute. He keeps patting his belly. A redhead. Just lets him buy all the barbed wire.
A redheaded primate. Dude, are you kidding me? Yeah. Bill Moonface. Yeah.
This fucking thing. Watch him eat an orange.
Yeah. Toss him a banana. Toss him a banana.
So, all right. So, that's if a foreign country, how would it change?
We had a monkey in Afghanistan that lived in our...
You're fucking shitting me.
No, his name was Spank, and he was kind of cool, but at the same time,
threw shit everywhere.
He didn't throw shit, but he peed on everything. So he'd climb up in the top of the tents and like pee, like, and he's got a human dick, right? Yeah. So it's like this little person.
Yeah, easy to jerk off.
Yeah, exactly. And so that was the other thing. Is like, at first we thought it was kind of cool, and he crawled on us and like crawl up our arms and up our back or whatever. But then you realize he's just dragging his dick up your arm. It's like, I don't think I want this thing on my arm anymore.
Get that unsheathed
dragging
thing.
It. Yeah. Like an iguana tail. Spank. No.
How big was it?
The monkey or the dick?
The monkey.
Proportionally, it was impressive.
Yeah, good for him.
He was probably...
About 16 inches tall?
8 pounds.
Really? Just a fucking monkey that hang out. Yeah. Where did it come from? What was the
they live wild there in the mountains?
And oh,
they're no like shit. They're like okay. Ground dwelling monkeys.
Okay, I wasn't sure if somebody was fucking.
Yeah, they live in the rocks.
We just fucked up this pet store. And
the locals just shoot at them if they like. They'll be like, ah, they like we shoot at ground squirrels. If the locals see them, they just fucking pop rounds at them.
See, a small monkey like that might be a step up from the raccoon, to be completely honest.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah. With their giant dicks Abu? And intimidating skills. Yeah.
Yeah. Pissing all over everything. Yeah.
Why you make piss in my house?
Oh, shit. Oh, my God. All right, Mike. Sorry, I derailed you.
No. Invasion. It sounds like you guys are all for a... government recruiting film. We're joining the resistance. Is that what I'm getting at?
Yes.
Yeah.
If it is.
Are the resistance.
We are. Yeah. Yeah.
Again. You've seen Red Dawn.
Yeah. Wolverines, boys.
That's right.
Wolverines. All right. Well, I'm going to start to put a bow on this.
All right.
So with all this happening, we get invaded. We become the modern day Afghanistan. We wear sandals all the time. We have good parties. How do you restore order to the world after an event like that happens?
Oh, yeah. So here it is, the hardest part.
Yeah. Yes.
That's why you got to start over again. Small level. It's going to be like agrarian society again. Just
make community by community good. And then as a broad brush, it paints the nation good.
Yeah. You're going to have to start with little... Yeah, small communities of 100 people that can self-sustain, like, within themselves. They have all the tool makers, the seamstress, the craft maker, the carpenters.
A lot of that will come down to luck as well.
Yeah.
Do you think then it is important as the nation rebuilds to spread, like, if you have a good community to go out and spread, like, help to rebuild, to provide?
Yes, I do.
Like, not... Like a carpetbagger post Civil War, but like to promote greatness.
I think that's what a lot of the flood myths in all the world mythologies are. Is there was a great cataclysm, and then someone came. Whether it's like Quetzalcoatl or
give knowledge.
What's the Hawaiian animated movie everybody likes? Moana. Uh-huh. Like I can't remember the god's name in that. Same thing.
Bagiki.
Yeah, like every mythology has someone who came after the flood to teach them society and agriculture and whatnot.
Yeah.
So I do think it is. You'll end up supporting people who align with you and not supporting people who don't. Yeah. So you will build a society based on your terms.
At what point, though, does that become government handout?
A couple thousand years, apparently.
That's when welfare begins.
Yeah.
Because I think about that. It's like, at what point are you building and making better, and what point are you propping people up? Do you think there could be moocher? I mean, there's going to be moochers post-apocalypse.
I think they'll be less tolerated because people will have come from...
Well, they'll thinned out and it'll be the hardest of the hard. Exactly. But then so it's the next generation.
Subsisting, but it takes a couple generations to forget.
Yeah. Right? Yes, very true. Those are good words. Jordan.
What's that?
How do we make it great again? How do you make... Take that Trump hat and how do we enact it?
He was TikToking. Sorry.
Yeah. I think if it came down to a situation where we were in small towns and small groups, I think that religious kind of ideologies and creating ideologies is what's going to be the way to communicate between the groups.
Spreading right? gospel. Spreading
well, just,
word.
Well, just,
not, it, I don't be, mean gospel be,
it's
in like
an
the
agreed
Bible.
Upon
spreading
rules
gospel
to live.
As yeah. like the word,
and,
spreading
and,
word.
And understand that that is what we're planning on doing with this new world that, you know, as horrible as it would be, it would be also an opportunity. Right, to like be at the front of this
rebuilding,
know, rebuilding experiment. Yeah. Now at
Jordan's
this point,
mobile tent.
Like I mean, the there's, service, there, yeah. there's. I think we'd be back to not having technology at that point, or we'd have technology, and it's like, well, shit, how do we fucking use this? You know what? Somebody try and work on that while we go plow these fucking fields with this ox, yeah. because that's what we have to do.
Yeah.
And it'd be this really trippy situation of being like not having.
Well, you'd we'd be the generation that had things like machinery that worked, knowing that we can't replace the parts because we don't have the factories to do it, and that the next generation will actually have to regress in technology.
Yeah.
Well, that. Oh, sorry, I'm looking at my notes. Don't talk to the notes, Mike. So that makes me think, though, like the most important thing would be like. Rebuilding the infrastructure of the nation to get power on, to get communications of phone lines. Maybe it does start in the mass gathering of people areas, which would be the cities, but say the cities are where the hospitals are. Like a town is going to have maybe doctors and the more facilities in the area they have. And if they start to have power and lighting and they can use pumps and tools and start to work again, and then you have communication to know what's happening. If something's happening bad 100 miles away, now I can instantly know and prepare and send resources. It would be worse for the next generation if you never put any effort into the rebuilding. I think the biggest thing you could do to in that situation of we're invaded, we went through it, we beat them, and now we're rubble would be Germany post 1944 or 1945. Rebuild. Well, so give the infrastructure back online.
Right. But ourselves and other countries supplied the parts and pieces for that rebuilding. Right. So imagine if you didn't have
true,
you
but
you couldn't just you can say, hey, I'll build a factory.
West, though.
How would you build a factory? West. Where would you cast the I-beams?
You would have to go U.S. West. You would be like the expansion of the United States.
Yeah,
everything would
be
local.
You'd be back to horses and carriages.
Yes. Yeah. So, but you would have to, infrastructure would be 1800s. Some forms of electricity.
Yeah, but there'd already it'd be crazy because there'd be roads. There'd be
littered
cars,
with car bodies. Yeah, that
there'd
don't
be
run.
Hot girls and crystals.
But that's
jerky girls.
But that's part of it, right? Like you would have steel here.
Yeah, true. Recycle. Start smelting.
You'd have a ton of fucking cars.
How long would it take to build the smelter?
Just a couple hot fires.
Couple
hot fires. Me and my squirrel.
I mean, not a problem.
Mr. Mittens on the press. Are you kidding me? Yeah, stamp out a couple fires.
You have to build all this stuff and make it work. But at least modify. Like, there's very little of it left.
Everything like pre-1800s was built that way. Hot fires.
But it took hundreds of years, is my point. It took generations to rebuild it because it's laborious and you have to start at the beginning. You got to be able to forge hand tools before you can forge machine parts.
We have such a leg up. Just like both you guys said, we live in a land of excess. There is, even though there's destruction, there will be so much left over to use over again. Factories, the parts.
What factories? They all got shipped overseas. They sent the machinery overseas.
No, but still the factory, Boeing. You could strip parts and start making stuff.
What would you do with Boeing parts?
They have autoclaves. They have stuff you could start using and making as smelters. You would have to
the amount of electricity you would need to turn on that autoclave.
That's why I say we have to go back to.
Right, so how are you? Are you going to be on your spin bike running the autoclave?
No, I got a bunch of wood. I got a bunch of charcoal.
I'll get a bunch of raccoons. We'll get a big water wheel.
Mr. Mittens is on it, dude.
There's a movie called Doomsday, and it's kind of crazy. And there's like this sickness that goes over this area, so they quarantine a group, and what they end up doing is building like a big wall and around this fucking place, and everybody inside of it is quarantined, and when they're trying to get out of it, they're like fuck you, and they either kill them when they're trying to get out or they push them back, you know, they just keep them in this fucking area. So then within that area there ends up being tribes, and there's like people that are in the city that are like these cannibalistic, weird, tribal fucking things. And then out in the countryside, there's like medieval, like they go back to like what was once
feudalism.
Yeah, but it's like,
my lord.
But they live in a fucking castle and shit. But it's funny because as the movie's going through and like looking through like the way they live as if there's a king and queen. It's like in the castle, it's like visitors, guest services. And it's like showing different signs like in this thing because it was an actual, like, it was, they're living in it now, but it was a museum. So there's like all the signage for like a fucking museum as they're walking through. I feel like that is as close to what we'd be going through.
Listen.
As
I worked at a place once, and I won't say what it is on here, but they had a rather large generator capacity and several thousand gallons of diesel underground in tanks. They had a freshwater pump that brought water out of Lake Washington to a filtration system. And
maybe we blur that last part out.
They had a couple of commercial kitchens.
Uh-huh.
All stock, like freezer stock. And I was like, if we ever needed to just bring 100 guys and take over a place where you could live for a long time, that's a good spot.
You'd have to go there.
That's true. Yeah, yeah. So no, you would have to go to that
place.
I need
my fire truck.
I need, with a raccoon.
Are you going to take your little Chinese Mao Zedong?
No, but my orangutan's going to play guitar up on that ladder.
Well, I'll send my squirrel his back. Well,
the hawk will lead the way.
That's the end of my questions, but I just opened a beer and I want to finish it.
All right.
Can I give 5 more minutes here?
Yeah, fuck yeah.
What's
Jordan, look at the look on Jordan's face. I think
someone's ready to go chop wood.
You just tapped him out.
What is your guys's, you can list a couple that you like, but I'd like to know like your favorite apocalypse movie. Because there's a bunch of good ones out there that
does Red Dawn count?
Yeah. Okay. Absolutely.
Right. Well, that's number one.
That's your go-to. That's your number one. That is a classic.
Yeah. I will never watch the remake. It's fucking bullshit.
It didn't Patrick capture Swayze, it.
Charlie Sheen.
That's true.
No.
You don't get better than that.
All you need is a dad to own a sports equipment store.
And avenge me.
Fight the resistance.
Avenge me.
That's what I learned from that movie.
That's probably my future with Nathan will be the kid standing up on the hill.
Did they really film it in Eastern Washington? Do you know where they filmed
they
it?
Said they
it,
did.
If that's what they say, it definitely looks like
Eastern Washington. I mean, that's where it's supposed to take place is like outside Spokane.
I thought it was in Colorado.
No, it's Washington.
I think in the movie it says Colorado. Like, it takes place in Colorado.
Pretty
They're
sure
fighting in the Rockies. I guarantee you.
Okay. Well.
Oh, listen. I've watched Red Dawn.
I'll be watching
it's one
it
of my favorite documentaries, and I've watched it many, many times.
You mean the film?
Yeah. The film.
Red Dawn? Yes. According to the film, Red Dawn.
Jordan, you're a movie guy. Yeah. You've got to have, and these are fantasies that you have, either often driving or walking down through the woods.
I do like, I was telling that story the other day. I was like, I didn't even think about it like that. And then he goes, why do you think I told you to walk in front of me? Like, oh, okay. Yeah.
You know how many people go missing every year? It's like, you take point.
That's hilarious.
Oh, my God.
I think apocalypse movie-wise, I do think that aspects of, like, Doomsday is pretty good. I mean, it's an action movie. It's kind of just like,
you some know, just Netflix
made. No, it's an older movie. Kind of set in the
Does
future.
Apocalypse Now count?
That's a war movie.
I know, but it says Apocalypse Now.
I hear you. It's in the title, but I think different definitions.
All right. Yeah, I think
for the Vietnamese it was. Let's be honest.
Yeah, I guess for them.
That's an invading force, yeah.
Yeah, I think, Red Dawn is, it's so hard.
It's tough to beat.
Tough to beat.
That's a good one.
You got all the, like, the horror genre, or, like, the suspense genre, like, 28 Days Later.
The zombie ones are good. There's that one where they all got locked in the mall.
What's the one with Woody Harrelson? Yeah, Zombieland?
Zombieland. That's a great one.
So, okay, so, if we're talking, like, that apocalypse.
Just,
Then, yeah, I mean, I think I like 28 Days Later a lot.
That was a good one.
Follow-up
was good, too.
There's one called Fido.
I don't think I've seen
which
that.
Is like an old, based in like the 50s, and it's like these zombies that just like kind of, it's a zombie movie, right?
Yeah.
Like these zombies just kind of like happen, but kids are like using them as for fucking pets, and they're walking them around on leashes, and they're like, my zombie, you know? Yeah, it's kind of. Yeah.
Do you ever see that one, The Road, like with Viggo Mortensen?
Yeah.
I mean, it's too
pushing
sad.
Pushing the cart.
Too sad. Kid. It's too intense when, like, when people are cannibals and it's like he's going to shoot his kid in that bathroom. Oh,
yeah. You know what else is good is The Book of Eli.
That's a good one. A really good I one. Like that yeah. one. There's a one called, it's either The Fog or The Mist. It's a Stephen King book. And like
some giant insect comes out of the fog.
Yeah, what it is the government has a military installation and they're like, no, but it's a good storyline. Like, they're fucking with portals. And they open a portal to a different dimension and creatures start coming in. And the whole thing pretty much takes place in a grocery store. And it's like all the psychological, like you have your hero, you have your masses of people that are just looking to survive. You have a lady that gets a god and religious complex and people start to follow the gospel. Like, it's a Stephen King book, but it's a good psychological. I think it's called The Mist. That's a pretty good one. But then it's like almost zombie is its own genre of survival, you know? Yeah.
It's like the unrealistic genre. And then you have, but then you also have all the disaster movies like
2012. And
well, what was the one where the everything froze over?
And yeah.
Like with flying. Jake Gyllenhaal?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tomorrow, End of Tomorrow?
Yeah. I like those disaster movies.
Yeah, yeah, when it's like, or asteroid ones.
Yeah.
There's
A Day One After Bruce Tomorrow. Willis and,
Armageddon.
Armageddon was good.
Is one, but there's that other one. Is it the lady from
Bird Box?
I need a blindfold, don't make a noise. Oh, that was a weird movie. Yeah, I don't know. Does that, but it's weird, like, it is, like, people will say you're a prepper, you're a nutball, you're all this, but it's even a huge genre, and it's one of the most box office.
Because it sells, because people fucking like it.
But it's because it's something that's inherently in people to think about what if something bad happened. That's a natural.
Why do we have that in our DNA?
It's happened, and it's happened. That's a survival mechanism. But it's weird to
but
think.
But now, what was the movie just that the Obamas did the other day?
Oh, End of the World or The World, End of Tomorrow?
Yeah,
you're something close. Like that.
Yeah, did you watch that?
It wasn't bad.
I watched probably two-thirds
and
of it.
And the ship
it started getting like preachy, and I was like, oh, God. It was the part where they're like, yeah, that's just how white people do it. When she was like, how come they're in our house or whatever? And the dad was like, well, it's because white people treat us this way or something. I was like, this is just another like preachy fucking.
That wasn't the weird part. The weird part was Sandra Bullock and the daughter's relationship, and then Ethan Hawking and the daughter's relationship. Well, that was
creepy, yeah.
Because
Sandra Bullock.
Or
whatever their name was, yeah.
The other one.
I was like, Bert
Replacer, not Sandra Bullock.
Anyway.
I don't know the names.
It wasn't a good movie, I didn't think.
No,
The Teslas crashing on the road was good.
I also felt like I was just waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, and nothing was ever happening.
The planes. So
I was kind of glad when I was finally able to be like, fuck this movie, I'm turning it off.
The planes and the boats having bad communication and crashing seems very likely.
Oh, sure.
They nailed that. The Tesla thing, it's tied into crazy. That. The internet going down and so much of tech going down, I thought they kind of nailed that.
Yeah.
I mean, they were our overlord, so they probably have an idea how it'll crash.
It is weird that they would broadcast that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an odd choice for them, for Obama to make that movie is an odd choice. You know?
I feel like it says something.
Yeah, I know.
I feel like it's, that. Yeah, that's definitely, oh, okay.
No, but I mean,
some original it's thought like, about it.
No.
Later.
There's also a Civil War movie coming out.
I know.
Have you seen any of the previews for it? I haven't really.
I have.
Does it look good?
It's been 3 months since I watched them, but it looked good.
Yeah.
It looked concerning.
Right?
If I'm being honest, it looked concerning.
2020, I thought maybe a Civil War could happen. Now, I don't feel like a Civil War would be as likely. I feel like it's more. No, things are divided, but I feel like it's starting to unravel more of that. Maybe it's someone else doing it.
You might be right.
It's not our own frustrations turning
each other. There's still enough tension that it could easily.
There's tension, but 2020 felt like it with the COVID stuff. But now it doesn't feel as much like it. It feels like.
Well, here's what I think. I think there's going to be another push for control. And everybody who sort of. I think there's going to be a lot more people pushing back this time.
Yeah. Well, look at vaccine rates.
Right.
Of everything. Yes,
that could cause things to boil over.
What is a rebound?
Vaccine rates of what?
Everything is down. People aren't vaccinating.
People don't trust
for
the CDC
anything.
Anymore. Like,
but even things like polio, things are like people aren't getting traditional vaccines as well because they feel fucked over by the system and what, I mean, RFK makes very good points and valid points, and it's like, yeah, anything in science. Look into it. Let's push. Let's see the truth. But vaccine rates overall have completely dropped. But it's a rebound effect from being pushed. It's like the kid that has a very strict parent, and then they completely rebel. They become a goth. Yeah,
the girl who can't have a boyfriend, she ends up
being the slut.
Sucking off the
whole
football
team. Exactly. But that's the idea. As a nation, we're having a rebound effect from COVID. You can honestly see it. And it's nice having metrics and data to see, you know? And that's kind of a take a poll or of the temperature of the people.
The thing is, like, even those, I don't believe it in. It's so hard to.
Yeah. You think it could be misconstrued data?
Yeah. Yeah. I think we're drifting off course and we should hit.
End?
Well, this is what you get with 1 year, guys. Have you ever felt like you had a linear path? I think not, and that's why you love us.
Don't come here for that.
And you want us. Get a raccoon.
See ya.
1 year, bitches.